from the world center of speed, the Daytona International Speedway, welcome to the 23rd running of the Daytona 500. From Daytona Beach, Florida, a CBS Sports exclusive, the 1981 Daytona 500, sponsored by Budweiser, for all you do, this Bud's for you. Goodyear, makers of Arriva, even its footprint tells you it's different. Wrangler, makers of jeans, boots, and sportswear for tough customers. And by Yamaha Motorcycles, Yamaha, the way it should be.
And a good afternoon from a windy Daytona Speedway. I'm Ken Squire, and welcome to America's Great Race. The cars that we park in our dooryards, that we drive to work and play today, take on epic proportion for a purse of nearly $800,000. The drivers of legendary status, men brave enough to take life in their bare hands and deal with it at 200 miles per hour. Over 100,000 have gathered around this 2.5-mile track to pay tribute to these drivers, these cars, and to this great event. Working with me here in our announce booth will be David Hobbs today, one of the great drivers from Europe and around the United States. Your feelings?
Well, North American stock car racing is absolutely unique in the field of motorsport, a true piece of Americana. But economic conditions have dictated that the size of the cars you drive out there on the highway have got smaller, and the same is applied to these guys here, but that downsizing has not been easy for these drivers. The cars are shorter and narrower, that makes them more twitchy, more nervous, and this boxier shape means the aerodynamics are not as good either, so they've had a lot of trouble in qualifying. NASCAR, which is not normally known as being flexible, has changed the rules twice, but these cars are still dangerous and can be very unpredictable.
Unpredictable indeed. Johnny Anderson, Massillon, Ohio, out of control in one of the twin 125-mile qualifiers on Thursday, literally flying this car into this series of sidewinders. He was unscathed. All he lost was his car and his wristwatch in that incredible crash. And then just moments later, Johnson City, Tennessee's Johnny Sailor, out of the same turn two against the same kind of wind we have today.
Well, in fact, even worse, because the headwind today is very, very strong as they turn into that back street. And as they come round turn two, it's going to be very, very problematical for them.
Covering the race with us today will be Ned Jarrett. Two times a Grand National Champion, 50 times a winner. And he's standing by with the front row cars right now.
Ken, I don't think there's ever been as many unanswered questions going into a 500-mile race as we have today. As a result of those two crashes and other things that's been happening during the week, NASCAR has changed the rules twice. Once since they've been on the racetrack. Since it rained yesterday, they didn't get any practice. And the rule changes dealt with the spoilers on the car, hopefully to put more pressure on the rear of the cars to stabilize them so they wouldn't lift off the ground as we saw those two cars. Sitting on the front row here today are two distinctively different cars. This is the car of Bobby Allison, which has a sloped rear window. Everyone feels that it will run better in the draft because of the aerodynamic design of the rear. On the outside is Darrell Waltrip's car. As you can see, it has a straight rear window, and the air flows straight across it much faster and does not put the pressure on the rear deck lid that he feels that it needs. And Darrell is one of the drivers that's very concerned here today about the handling qualities of his car. And you mentioned the wind. That is a factor here. Could add to their problems.
A Pontiac sits on the pole. The last time a Pontiac came through, 1962, with the late, great Fireball Roberts. Right now, one of America's leading motorsports journalists, Brock Yates, has more on the pole sitter.
Ken, you can find 50 of the most competitive race teams in the world in a small area like Daytona for 2 weeks, and one thing I'll guarantee you is controversy. Meet the controversy of 1981, the Pontiac Le Mans of Bobby Allison on the pole, clearly the fastest car in the race. It is a car that they sort of slipped in here in a quiet little use of the rule book. It's a legal car. The other crews say it's not legal, but it is clearly legal. And it looks as if it is going to be banned perhaps after this race. It is without question the car to beat in this event. They say we're going to go all the way. They're going to try to win this thing from the pole, and it is going to be a car to watch for the afternoon.
We'll be back with more live coverage on this windy day at Daytona in a moment. The Daytona International Speedway, 2.5 miles of subtlety. And let's take a look at what these 42 competitors are going to face today, David.
Okay, into turn one today with a tailwind at probably about 205 miles an hour. They'll come in right up that wall, cut down for a low line, then the wind and centrifugal force is going to take them up. There's a couple of bumps in the middle of turn one, but turn two is the really tricky one, and today with the wind it's going to make it even worse.
Just a touch in turn two and you can be in trouble. Remember 1979, Donnie Allison number one, Bobby Allison 15, Cale Yarborough early in the race, sliding out of control in turn two, where there have been so many problems before.
Well, they were just entering that 3,500-foot backstretch, but they're both going down the grass there, which is very wet in this film, and, of course, is very wet today as well. The end of the backstretch, of course, today they'll be down a little bit on speed, about 197, 198, as they turn into turn three. Again, they'll start high, go to the middle of the road, and then sweep up as they go through three and into four. Then four is very bad. There's the bump as they go over the tunnel where it says Daytona at the top of the banking there. And this is also a corner that leads to an awful lot of trouble as they come off four, get up close to the wall.
This was the incident in 1979. Eight cars in trouble. Harry Gant's car shoots from the outside of the track to the inside, slams into the barrier at 190 miles an hour, and is thrown back into the tri-oval area.
Of course, this is one of the problems with these NASCAR crashes. Sometimes your crash turns into everybody else. Now, assuming they get around the first four corners, which are 31-degree banking, they come into the tri-oval here, which is only 17. But today, the wind's going to be behind them, sweeping them through there at tremendous speed. And for some reason or other, when that 17 degrees levels off to flat again, it too can lead to some very unpleasant moments.
As it did 1 week ago, coming down out of the tri-oval. A host of ARCA cars, Bob Jack, 75, Bob Dodder, 76, spinning, crashing into the wall, down to the inside of turn one, and disaster for Halpern and Bob Dodder, Jr. So that's a look at this 2.5 mile track and some of what can happen here in the course of a major stock car race. CBS this year has two cameras in cars. One, Richard Childress, is number three, and the other in car number 44, Terry Labonte, the young driver who won Darlington last year. And you are now inside his automobile, and we intend to bring you some very unique pictures before this day is done of what racing is all about on the Grand National Tour of NASCAR. There's Terry Labonte in his car and getting set, and probably very nervous at this moment as we prepare for the start. The starting grid for today's 23rd running of the Daytona 500. Ned Jarrett is standing on pit road alongside the leaders as they'll take the green for today's race.
A very strong field here on the front row. In fact, it's strong all the way through, Ken. One of the strongest 500s we've seen. Sitting on the pole is Bobby Allison of Hueytown, Alabama, a former winner of this Daytona 500, the favorite here today. From us at CBS, good luck, Bobby.
Thank you, Ned.
And spanking him on the outside is the car number 11 to be driven by Darrell Ultrup of Franklin, Tennessee, one of the fastest cars here. He's driving the Junior Johnson prepared car, always a strong car in the field. And in the second row here today are the Ford products. Neil Bonnet on the inside of the second row. He's been running very strong here. Neil, we understand that your dad was not able to be here with us today.
Yeah, my dad had a heart attack a little while back. I just want to tell him to sit there in Birmingham, enjoy this thing, see if I can't win it for him.
Well, we'll be watching what happens. And on the outside of Neil Bonnet on the second row is Benny Parsons. Benny, a former winner of the Daytona 500. He's driving the Bud Moore prepared car and another of the Ford products that do so well in the draft here. Starting in the third row is the car number 88, Ricky Rudd. And he had some problems with his car. Ricky, you were the last car on the line here this morning. What was wrong?
Well, they changed, ended up changing motors first thing this morning, and they went ahead and put a different engine in it.
and they had a little problem with the clutch, and they found out after they put it all together, they had to pull the motor halfway back out and change the clutch, and it cost them a lot of extra time.
And it has to be some anxious moments for Ricky Rudd, not knowing exactly how this car will perform. On the outside of the third row is last year's Daytona 500 winner, Buddy Baker of Charlotte, North Carolina, one of the hardest chargers in all of auto racing. And then making up the fourth row here today is the current NASCAR champion, Dale Earnhardt. Dale, how do you feel?
Great, Ned. Ready for it.
He's ready for him. He's always ready. One of the hardest chargers, young lions in this sport. And flanking him on the outside of the fourth row is the king of stock car racing, seven-time Grand National Champion, six-time winner of the Daytona 500, Richard Petty. And Ken, that next row has a lot of talent in it also.
Indeed it does, Ned. Let's now review for you the rest of the starting field that you'll be watching live today here on CBS. Moving to row number five, David Pearson, the Silver Fox 1970 Daytona 500 champion, and beside him, A.J. Foyt, the 1972 champion, driving for Jim Gilmore. In row number six today is Kyle Petty, the son of Richard Petty, who qualified well, and Terry Labonte, the fellow who won at Darlington 1 year ago for Billy Hagan. Row number seven, the winner of the Le Mans sports car race, Don Whittington, and from Bellingham, Massachusetts, Jeff Bodine. In row eight, Dave Marcus of Wausau, Wisconsin, and Bill Elliott, an outstanding runner from the Southeast, in his car number nine. Row number nine is car number 19, rookie Ronnie Sanders, and the second CBS Campbell, Richard Childress. Row 10 will be Ronnie Thomas, and alongside him from Martinsville, Virginia, Buddy Arrington. In row 11, the offshore powerboat champion last year, Bill Elswick from Florida, and the Burt Reynolds Hal Needham car driven by Stan Barrett. In row 12 is Glenn Jarrett, whose dad is down on pit road for CBS and Bruce Hill. In row 13, it'll be James Hilton of Inman, South Carolina, and Alabama's Jimmy Means. The 14th row is last year's Rookie of the Year, Jody Ridley, the Donlevy car, and Tommy Gale. Row 15, two-time Daytona champion, Cale Yarborough, and beside him, Minnesota's Blackie Wengren. The 16th row is Harry Gant, one to look for today, and the Virginian, number 68, Lenny Pond. In row 17, starting where his brother won this race from, Donnie Allison and Joe Milliken. In row 18, Indianapolis champion Johnny Rutherford and Billy Harvey of Florida. Row 19, Elliott Forbes Robinson, the great sport car driver, and Richard Brooks of California. In row 20 will be Don Sprouse, a rookie driver, and last year's Indy rookie, Tim Richmond. Row 21, J.D. McDuffie, and the fellow who originally came from Horseshoe, North Carolina, Cecil Gordon in number 24. That is the starting grid for today's 23rd running of the Daytona 500, and they are just about prepared for the national anthem and then the command to fire the engines for 500 miles of great American auto racing, the NASCAR stock cars. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem. U.S. Air Force Band, Warner Robins Air Force Base in Georgia.
Ladies and gentlemen,
parading the colors. And now we're just about ready for the command to fire the engines for today's race. Charles Pilliard, the Grand Marshal of today's race, is about to give the command turn the engines over for the first time for the 23rd running of the Daytona 500. Very cold day, very windy day. They'll take a little extra time off the road.
Start your engines.
Daytona 500 field is assembled on pit road. 3 weeks of work, months of preparation, building cars. These are the, for most of these teams, the only cars of this size they have. Now gets put to the test.
We hear that NASCAR officials are checking the oil temperatures before they're allowing these cars to move off, which is a very wise precaution because they run extremely high engine pressures in these cars, and if they set off with it too cold, pop an oil line early on and either cause a wreck or at least upset the track.
You're looking to Bobby Allison, pole sitter, 194 miles an hour. Fireball Roberts, 1962, won the pole, won the 125-mile qualifying race, went on to win the Daytona 500. The only man to ever do so. Today, with a Pontiac, as it was in 62, Bobby Allison hopes to do it again. Back car number 28, the Silver Ghost, on the pole for the third straight year for the 500. There's Neil Bonnet, the younger member of the Alabama gang. The Allison brothers, Neil Bonnet, short track driver named Red Farmer, who made so much racing history in Birmingham over the years. Mobile. Mechanics are being told to move away and go back behind the wall. Pace car is beginning to roll. Ladies and gentlemen, the field for the 23rd Daytona 500 is rolling out. Ernie Moore signaling two laps, and they will be racing.
Two laps again to give these cars a chance to warm everything up, the transmissions, the differential units, and of course the engines. Neil Bonnet, who we saw sitting on the second row there, in his Thunderbird, which has proved to be exceptionally good in the draft, and that over a 500-mile stretch is going to help him.
Look at those flags along the top of pit row. They are blowing straight out. That's a 40-mile-an-hour breeze. That will push you down the straightaway. It'll break you down the backstretch. Everyone seems to be rolling. All the cars are coming off pit row. Shortly, the start. A lot of drivers with brand new teams, a wholesale change of positions as far as drivers and cars are concerned. And Brock Yates took a look at the musical chairs that have been played for this Daytona 500.
One of the unique things about NASCAR Grand National Racing is that everybody's on a first-name basis. For example, you've got a collection of drivers named Cale and Dale and Benny and Bobby and Buddy and Ricky and David and Daryl, all driving high-priced iron owned and prepared by men named Junior and Haas and Bud and MC and Harry. And you kind of get used to certain combinations of these people. For example, last year, Cale was in Junior's car number 11, Benny was in MC's 27, Bobby was in Bud's 15, Buddy was in Harry's 28, David was in Haas's number 1, and Daryl was in the Gardner Brothers' 88. Now, the Gardners are Yankees, so we don't call them by their first names. Confused? Wait till you hear about 1981, because it's all changed now. Cale's with MC, Benny's driving for Bud, Bobby's with Harry, Buddy's with Haas, David's driving for newcomer Joel Halpern, Daryl's with Junior, and Ricky Rudd's with the Gardner Brothers. All right, now that you got all that, let's run through it one more time. Cale is with Haas, Benny's with, we know Richard Petty's in number 43. Does anybody have a program?
Yeah, we're going to need one before this day is over. Field is on the back straightaway, and we are one half lap away from a start. Getting ready inside NASCAR control to hit the button and turn them loose.
Bill Gazaway is standing there, the man of iron. But even Bill's had to modify his rules.
Don't let it get too far behind you now, caution car.
200 laps, 500 miles. Last year, the fastest 500-mile race ever run in the history of motorsport. Right here, Buddy Baker did it in the car that's on the pole today. Jimmy Means from Alabama, number 52, took one preliminary lap. His car is now on pit road. So 41 cars are on the field as they move down out of turns 3 and 4, up on the 31-degree banking. Pace car has its light off. Bill Gasway instructing the car, you can hear him.
So when you come off, stay up there as long as you can. Hold it now. Don't get too far inside yet. All right, come on like you're coming. Now, stay up next to the grass when you come down here on your right.
Pretty good start.
All right, Mr. Starr.
Pretty good start.
Let it out, Harold.
We have a start. Harold Kinder lets them out. And down at a first turn goes car number 11, Neil. Whether it be number 11 of Harold for the lead.
David Pearson went down to the apron as they came off the travel to try and sneak up a couple of places, but it didn't really do him a lot of good.
Back straight away, coming to full song. Swapping positions, 20 acres back in front. Teams of Alabama's pulled off pit road back on the track. Here they come for the first time by. All 42 cars are now on the track. Coming down to complete lap number one. Allison in first, Nick Bonnet in second, Waltrip is in third, Buddy Baker is in fourth. In the fifth spot is Ricky Rudd. Sixth spot is David Pearson. And the field is back into turns one and two. Just 199 laps to go, David.
Turn two is going to give him some trouble today, I'm sure, with a strong wind. Buddy Baker drafting there, being followed very closely by Neil Bonnet. Up the outside, down the inside comes Darrell Walton, car number 11.
The junior Johnson repair number 11, streaking along the bottom. The Wood brothers have their 21 on the outside. There you see the leader, Bobby Allison.
Buddy Baker in the red car number one there, lying in the fourth spot. He's trying a different spoiler today, and this is the first test laps he's given that spoiler. I tell you, he's a brave man to make a major change like that before a 500-mile race without trying it first.
Benny Parsons lies seventh, going eighth, Taylor and Hart. Peterson two. Will Bobby Allison be the second man in Daytona 500 history to win the pole position, the qualifier, and then go on to win the Daytona 500? Only once before in history has it happened.
Bobby Allison and Neil Bonnet putting a bit of daylight between themselves and the rest of the field here as they come around turn three into turn four.
The Alabama gang all together up front. There's Kaley Arborough. Still trying to fight his way up to the front. Yarborough is on the move, the number 27. You see him up on the wall, fighting his way around rookie Ronnie Sanders. Now back to the leaders as they approach turn one. And Bobby Allison and the kid he began in racing, Neil Bonnet, try to draft away from the field, but that's not working. They're being caught up in the back straightaway.
There's four very fast cars. Neil Bonnet trying for the first time to get by Bobby Allison down, and he slingshots by, and that's the thing we're going to see a lot of today because they're driving into the wind. The second car is so protected by the first car, he picks up momentum and slingshots by, and we're going to see a lot of that today.
Ford Thunderbird out in front. Bonnet first, Allison second. Running for Darrell Walker. Maintaining that fourth position, Buddy Baker, last year's winner, now on the Haas Ellington team. There you see the automobiles coming out of turn number two and in the back straightaway as Baker sustains and stays in there. And Bonnet really begins to show some power and some authority with the Wood Brothers car.
And Buddy Baker's pulled himself up to third and now pulling himself up to second in the draft of Bobby Allison, who goes back into the lead again. Fords of Neil Bonnet and Benny Parsons showed very good form in the 125-mile qualifying race. They proved to be exceptionally good at drafting, but not very good at leading. And obviously, they want to try and change that today.
Falling back to third is Neil Bonnet. In that fourth position is Darrell Waltrip. Baker taking a shot at second. that car may be throwing some smoke, as is Ricky Rudge, number 88, and the observers on the four points of the track are watching those two cars carefully. Buddy Baker in command for the first time. Baker out in front. See that car hop and tremble as he comes off turn four.
It almost looked to me as if the wheel actually came off the floor. It can't have done, but it was bouncing over that tunnel entry. That's a very tricky part of this course, and as they go through the travel, they're side by side.
A lot of shifting of positions. Neil Bonnet, the Wood Brothers, number 21, seeking their fifth Daytona 500 victory. It will be the first for Neil Bonnet. The Wood Brothers have been here since the very beginning and have some great winners in Paley Armour, A.J. Foyt. Here comes a shot on the inside, and Baker, last year's winner, goes back in front. Allison, the 77 champion. Waltrip goes to third. Bonnet dropping to fourth. Look at that running.
Waltrip got out of the draft there. Bonnet was still in it and managed to retake third place away from Waltrip, who tried to slip down the inside.
The fifth position is David Pearson. Six is Earnhardt. Seventh is Ricky Rudd. Running eighth is Lamonte.
Money Baker, the last year's winner, now leading this race. Dale Earnhardt's come up to join that draft for the lead.
Buddy Baker, who's been here since 1960. 22 years of trying, he won this race a year ago. Now with a new team. Team that first Donnie Allison, then David Pearson went for a year ago. Now Baker at the controls, he's beaten past. Bobby Allison down the front. Neil Bonnet, the Alabama gang, again showing their authority.
Bobby Allison has got the car, there's no doubt about it. He is showing tremendous form here. I don't think he's going to be able to run away in line, but he's going to be so strong all afternoon, it's going to be very difficult for these other guys to really consistently stay out of
track. Eight laps complete.
And now you see that front, that leading bunch has picked up cars. We have Ricky Rudd there, Dale Earnhardt, David Pearson, and Richard Petty is winding them in. And so right behind Richard Petty is Don Willington, the car number 93, the yellow number 93. So this lead car draft, that started up as a four-car draft, is rapidly building up into a 10-car draft.
Back comes Neil Bonnet. Bonnet going back for the lead another time. You have to be so careful out here. But how can anyone be patient and prudent at nearly 200 miles per hour?
It's very difficult, and I think the story in the pit area over the last 2 days has been mental strain, and these guys, these cars are twitching when they hit the ball, and I think there's going to be a lot of worn-out brains as this race develops as the day goes on. Look at that car coming on the lead draft now. Two, three, four, up to about 12 cars in it.
And the car in front, Neil Bonnet. The Wood Brothers from Packard County, Virginia, a great car construction outfits, a family, build great racing cars, continue to put a car up in front year after year here at the Speedway. And now you're with Terry Labonte. He's right behind David Pearson. You're with him at 190 miles per hour. Look at the vibration. Look at his hands as he works through that banking.
Terry Labonte, in fact, is in that lead draft. He's right at the back of it. There's David Pearson in front of him. David Pearson is lying in, wherever he is, fifth spot.
Now, Terry Labonte is off to a great start. He finished second at Riverside, California this year. He's out of Corpus Christi, Texas, and he is a very good driver. Now we have trouble on Buddy Arrington's car in the pits. They're changing the right front tire. We are working the 11th lap. You're in lap number 11. Arrington, Virginia driver, on pit road. Meanwhile, back straightaway. Leader coming down to turn number three. Neil Bonnet in front. Bobby Allison in second. A Ford Thunderbird in front. A Pontiac in second. And car number one, an Oldsmobile, runs in third in the 23rd annual running of the Daytona 500. Daytona 500. The observers, NASCAR observers, watching number 11 for smoke out of Darrell Waltrip's car. Take a look at this replay just two laps ago. Watch what happens in the backup here.
Don Whittington, car number 93, just gets out of shape there in the travel. He and Benny Parsons, right at the back there, tag each other. Don Whittington bounces off. Both of them carried on, but they did tend to lose the draft from these, the front runners.
A resurgent Neil Bonnet, number 21, stays out in front. Into second moves the national champion from 1 year ago, Dale Earnhardt. Let's go to Brock Yates on pit road.
Ken, I'm here with Leonard Wood, the crew chief on the Wood Brothers car. Neil Bonnet's number 21. Leonard, everyone seems surprised that Neil is running this strong early in the race. It was our understanding that Bobby Allison was going to try to break the draft, run alone in the early laps, but he's been unable to get away from Neil. Are you pleased?
Yes, I am. We figured that we could stay with him in the draft. You know, we felt our car was handling pretty well, you know. Maybe a little bit better than some of the cars, but I believe you'll see as the race goes along that the track will get a little bit more slippery, and a lot of the guys will begin not handling as well towards the end, so we'll have to wait about 102 miles and see what happens then.
Okay, thank you, Leonard. A very patient team, as you know, Ken, so they'll be here at the end. I'll guarantee that.
One of the true gentlemen of motorsport, Leonard Wood. Now, the tough customer himself, Dale Earnhardt, national champion, is out in front in car number two. And watch for him to skedaddle in the Rod Osterlund car out of California, that team, prepared by Roland Melodica. Once again, you're with Labonte, and you are trailing Ricky Rudd. That is Ricky Rudd, and you can see some smoke.
Darrell Waltrip. He's following Darrell Waltrip. Down that back straight, goes down to the inside, thinks about having it go by, but decides not to this lap. But you can see that smoke. And he pulls right down below Darrell. Can't quite make it. You can see the vibration as they come down the short 1,600 foot straightaway into the tri-oval, just underneath our company position. There we have a look at
the Monty himself. That camera making that move. That's the uniqueness of our new CBS camera. You are looking at the windshield. This camera has the ability to move inside the car. You're watching the driver fighting his way into the corner, moving up again on Darrell Waltrip and taking another shot at him.
See how Labonte likes to stay just a bit low on Darrell as they go through that corner. That's the safest place through these 31-degree bank corners.
Bobby Allison moving on the underside of number two, Earnhardt, and going after number 21. Neil Bonnet another time. Buddy Arrington, number 67, is out of the race. Arrington has gone to the garage area, number 67.
Boy, those in-car pictures really bring it back to you. That's fantastic.
Running in ninth position continues to be Parsons. In tenth is A.J. Foyt. A little further back, he's been in 11th. Whittington in the 12th position. And Jeff Bodine, the car out of the state of Maine, the Bear car, is running in the 13th position. That's number 25, Ronnie Thomas of Christiansburg, Virginia, on pit road. Leading. Bonnet, number 21 first, Allison riding second. The speed in the first 10 laps was a very slow 188.285 miles per hour. The record, Buddy Baker in car 28 a year ago at 193.548. Oh, we have trouble. A car is bounced off the wall, losing the front end. The tire coming out of the machine. And that is Blackie Wendering from Bloomington, Minnesota. Caution is out for the first time today. Wendering has lost the right front tire. It's lying up near the track in the tri-oval. And Wengren has crashed again. He hasn't had much success here, David.
No, I think that these cars, these more twitchy cars, definitely put drivers like Blackie Wengren in that class. It really is very difficult for guys like to drive on these super speedways where you're obliged to start lapping at 190 miles an hour. And I think it's really just too much for them. And maybe they should restrict their activities to some of the shorter tracks.
Blackie Wengren. Bringing out the first caution. It's coming in lap 19. First caution of the day, and we should see Bobby Allison pit right here.
Well, of course, the trouble with this race is so boring because they're only averaging 188. I don't know why we're even bothering with it. I mean, it's so slow.
Here is car number 21. Bonnet followed by Allison on pit road. Baker, Earnhardt, let's go to Brock Yates.
We're done. We're down here in the Bobby Allison pit with a Rainier crew. They're going after all four tires. That's a routine thing in these early pit stops. They'll make a four-tire change.
make sure that their tire wear is good. The car appears to be running very nicely. I talked earlier to Waddell Wilson, the crew chief. He just gave me a thumbs up. He's sitting with the leaders. He apparently doesn't have the power to clearly break away from the field, which may be a bit of a surprise, but it's very early in the race. They don't seem to be making any chassis changes or adjustments. Cars down off the jacks and underway. A good quick stop for Bobby Allison.
Almost getting set by Cecil Gordon as they came out, number 24.
I expect Bobby Allison and his whole crew, Harry Rainier, the owner, and Waddell Wilson, their engine man.
Something's happened on car 11, and they may have dropped the jack on number 11 on pit road. They have problems on car number 11. Machine is down.
They've obviously left off the left front wheel, because you can see that corner's down. Now they'll have a heck of a job to get the jack under it to lift it up again.
You seldom see a junior Johnson crew make that kind of error, but apparently something has happened to miss on pit road for number 11 today. Waltrip, who had such high hopes for this one after winning how many thousands of dollars here before the race began?
I think he won a cool $87,000 before this race started.
He's trying to beat the pace car, or he's going to go a lap down. You see him pulling out, and the pace car is coming just out of the tri-oval. He beat the pace car. Jeanette Jarrett.
We're standing with Blackie Wangren, who just hit the wall. Blackie, what happened?
Some runner to right side broke.
Gave you quite a ride there.
Yeah, real thrill.
Blackie, this track hasn't been too kind to you in the past.
Oh, I had a bad luck last year and again this year, but we'll be back.
How are the cars handling out there today in this wind?
Mine was handling real good.
Did any of the other cars look squirrely that you were running around?
The Oldsmobiles and the Buicks are real squirrely. I took it easy to start when I was just going to start picking up the pace when it broke.
And Ken, when we say squirrely, that means the cars are moving around quite a bit on the racetrack.
I'll say they're moving around. They look like a Saturday night square dance out there as they frolic about at 190 miles per hour. We'll be back with more of the Daytona 500 live on CBS in a moment. Two laps, 55 miles complete, 178 laps remaining in our live coverage of Daytona 500. And car number 11, the Darrell Waltrip car, is back on pit road. They're making all kinds of adjustments on the machine down there. There's a man inside the car working. Let's go to Brock Yates.
Ken, they've had a serious set of problems here. They let the car go early on their pit stop just a couple of laps ago because they had loosened lug nuts on the left side. The car was dropped down off the jack. It's apparently bent the left front fender, which is the major problem. They had the hood up. I'm not sure what that was all about, but they lost a serious amount of time. The crew is concerned this is an odd error for one of the finest crews in this league, and Darrell Waltrip's down seriously.
Well, the car seems to be smoking, so that's probably what they had the hood up for, but obviously the bent fender's not going to help them either.
At 20 laps, 50 miles, Bonnet first, Allison was then in second, Baker was third, Rudd was fourth. It was Earnhardt running in the fifth position, Whittington in sixth. And there is Ricky Rudd's number 44, which is carrying our CBS camera. Terry Labonte's number 44, which is carrying our camera. And now he's looking out through the back.
And he must be looking at, he's not looking at Don Whittington, we can't see.
To me, like it was the car of Bobby Allison back in there. Anyway, at 20 laps, 50 miles, Labonte was running in eighth behind number 11, Waltrip. The ninth position car was Parsons, 10th was Foyt, going 11th was Elliott. The 12th position car was number 27, Cale Yarborough, and Richard Petty was in 13th. And there you see the average speed of 185. That's not a record. The record is 193.548 by Buddy Baker 1 year ago, racing the fastest 500-mile race in history.
Well, that just shows right there the tremendous difference between this year's cars and next year's cars. But this is the first race with the new downsized cars, and you can just leave it to these NASCAR crews and drivers. By the time we get halfway through this season, they'll have got over their problems, and we'll be right back to speed.
Stan Barrett in the pits in the Burt Reynolds Hal Needham car, making its first appearance here. Stan Barrett, well-known Hollywood stuntman who ran four races last year, never finished worse than 13th.
As you can see, that yellow line on the bottom of his car denotes he's a rookie, so that when you're a Bobby Allison coming up to overtake someone, it gives you a clue as to what their skills are. But young Stanley Barrett, who's done 700-odd miles an hour on ground, now cruising around a miserable 185.
Right. 739 miles an hour over the face of the earth in the Needham rocket car. Wanted to take a stab at stock car racing, and Burt Reynolds and Hal Needham hooked his team together. Needham is here today, observing, probably as nervous as Stanley is.
I think he's going to jump off the grandstand roof later on.
Field in the back straightaway. We are working in the 24th lap. We are in lap 24 as they come around, and they should be taking green when they come by. We understand there's another problem on the wall trip, car number 11 to Brock Yates.
Ken, I'm with Junior Johnson in the Darrell Waltrip pit. Junior is now talking with Darrell over the radio. I'm not sure what he's talking about. We'll get to him as quickly as he stops his communication. Darrell is apparently telling them some more problems out there. They certainly had a handful already early in this race, and who's to know what else is to come for them.
On the restart,
he's going to... One of the craftiest men in this business, as you know.
Ricky Rod in first. Amati is in second. Gerald Amati running in second. Ricky Rod on the point as they go down. Harry Gamp running in third. Whittington is in fourth, but Baker is breaking upside, trying to move through.
So our camera car now lying in second spot as they go around turn two, come down up the back straight, following Ricky Rudd, one of the youngest men in this race. He's only 24 years old, rookie of the year in 1977, and with a new strong team, the Dygard team, which Darrell Waltrip left last year, this could be Ricky Rudd's best year yet.
Number 44. Terry Lavati of Corpus Christi, Texas. His dad got him started in racing. Let's go to Brock Yates.
Ken, I'm with Junior Johnson. He can talk now. Junior, have you got your problems sorted out now?
Well, we got just a little bit of hauling somewhere now that's dropping over the dog. I've spoken a little bit, and it ain't leaking out very near the car, so it's just a seat somewhere now. We don't think it's no baby problem with it.
Okay, thank you. Believe it or not, Ken, it's so loud down here, I couldn't hear a word he said, but I presume you know what he's talking about. Back to you.
They think they can get along with the problem. But right now, problems for Ricky Rudd as Terry Labonte, in car number 44, moves in on his rear bumper.
And back into third spot goes car number 28. This is going to give us some sort of clue as to just how fast Bobby Allison's car really is, because he was back in sixth, and he's already up to third, and it just depends how quick he can cover that gap.
Taylor Yarbrough away in the back of that flock as they come around to complete the 27th lap. Yarbrough is running about 13th in that field. Gillis and Gillis do, the 1968-77 champion. And there you get a feeling for the tremendous speed these 3,700-pound racing cars are dealing with. Back they go on the back straightaway.
Terry DeMonte drafting right behind Ricky Rudd as they go into turn three. You haven't...
Earlier we talked to Cale Yarbrough in 27, as he has his work cut out for him, starting back in 29th position. Prior to the start of today's race, he talked about the frustration so far back.
I feel like I should be there, but I can't get there. You know, I'll say again, maybe things will work better during the race, but it's kind of disappointing to have to sit back. You don't like to sit there, you like to be up front, and of course, if things work good, that's where we'll go if at all possible.
Well, there you see number 27 going down out of the back second turn into the back straightaway. He is running in 12th position and attacking Denny Parsons for the 11th. Meanwhile, in front, there goes Bobby Allison down beneath Terry Labonte. He pulls up on 88 and takes a shot at him. Bobby Allison going back for the front position another time.
Well, that must be pretty discouraging, actually, for the others, because he really caught up very fast.
He's not by.
But you'll notice that he can run well, very low. Everybody else has to take the high line around here. Bobby Allison seems to be able to put that car where he wants. And Danny Parsons is drawn into the pits.
Number 15, the Buckmore car, which won here for Bobby Allison, is now on pit road. And the Whittington car is on pit road. Let's go to Ned Jarrett.
Ken, one of the cars that started way back there with Cale Yarborough was Harry Gant. And before the caution, he was one of the fastest cars on the track. He's now in that battle for the fifth position out there. Bob Johnson, the crew chief on the car, standing by. Bob, you must be pleased with the way that car was running out there.
Yeah, we're real happy today. You know, we had our share of problems at the beginning of the week. And Harry just said it was a little loose before the yellow, and I guess I tightened it a little too much, but we can straighten it out, I hope.
Is he saying that it's too tight now?
Yeah, a little bit.
And he's doing a good job of drafting, Ken, and Harry Gant has become a master at that technique.
A broken windshield on car number 93, Don Whittington. And he's just coming back on the track now. Whittington out of Florida as he worked the 30th of 200 laps. They're also reporting a windshield on car one is beginning to break. Buddy Baker has a hole in his windshield on car number one. That will certainly disturb the aerodynamics on the Haas Ellington car.
Certainly disturb the aerodynamics around your helmet, too. It's not very pleasant to have a broken windscreen. That's a shame for Don Whittington, who was putting on a pretty good show there for a relative rookie for this extremely dodgy drafting procedure. There's Buddy Baker, car number one, being closely followed by Richard Petty, 43. A car that we all know pretty well by now.
Buddy Baker is running six.
The lead car draft picking up to a 9 and 10 car draft. Dale Earnhardt just trailing behind Richard Petty there. He's catching up on him.
We have another broken windshield. Number 17, Glenn Jarrett's windshield is broken. Once again, you're with Terry Labonte in car number 44. He is running in fourth position. There he is, right up here, the leaders, waving. See the sign that says, "Hi, Justin"? That's for his one-week-old son, who is back in Texas watching this race today.
You can put all sorts of messages on that, can't you? Please send help, refreshments, or anything else. You can see his rev counter there, glued at just over between 7,000 and 8,000 RPM. 8,000 being the last figure there, and it's running at about, 7,600 RPM. And our camera can zoom right in on him.
How's that for 190 mile per hour ride?
And you can see that as he goes into that corner, he loses about 500 RPM. Now, that's not because he's lifting off. That's just tire scrub as these cars go into the turn.
Well, you're right there with the leader, number 44, Terry Labonte, who's running with the leaders in fourth place. And now we're looking out the back. Oh, look at that man, right up on
him. Buddy Baker right behind him, and right behind him is Richard Petty. He pulls away a bit as he goes into turn four. Now let's see if Buddy can catch him up in the draft. They go down off the trail. Oh, sorry, the back straight.
Here's Baker pulling up. Baker right up on the rear bumper. And you can see the hole in Baker's windshield. A little break up here for just a moment. Back with the leaders, Bobby Allison, 28, still has command. Conant is in the second position. There's the number one car that's having a problem, and our camera car, number 44, right in front of him. Number 47, Gant is back on pit road. Bobby Allison in front. There's Gant. He is a tremendous driver, cut his teeth in the modified ranks of NASCAR, and that Race Hill Farms car from Connecticut, doing proud for a while, but now having problems. We will continue with more live coverage of the Daytona 500 after this word from your local station. Four laps are complete in the 23rd Daytona 500, 85 miles down, 415 to go. Harry Gant pitted, came back on the track. He is pitting again under green as the folks in the grandstand, looks like a tennis match, watching these guys go by at 190 miles per hour. There's a little more at stake than a ball and so forth on this one.
Nearly as much money, too.
Almost. At least they're willing to raise the consolation. On the back straightaway, in the front-running position is Tommy Allison. In second is Neil Bonnet, maintaining the third in a very stout drive. Here comes Bonnet to the inside. Parsons in third. Tremendous race for the lead going into turn number three. Almost side-by-side. Bonnet then had to fall back. Bonnet made a real stab at the lead there.
Well, there we see the two good Fords out here. Neil Bonnet, number 21, and Benny Parsons, number 15. But unfortunately, Benny is a lap down. But he's right in there with his lead car draft. So what he needs now is to get right to the front, have a yellow flag situation, cross the line first, and that will give him his lap back.
Terry Labonte with Baker right on his rear bumper. Now Baker's pulling up and trying to pass. you're riding with Terry Labonte, and Baker is right there trying to storm through. There you see Richard Petty right behind Baker, now going to the outside.
There you see the hole in Buddy Baker's windscreen, right up to the back of Terry Labonte, down the inside.
He's pulling alongside. He's shooting through to go by. Up in front.
So Buddy Baker,
Bonnet has taken the lead.
So Buddy takes fourth spot away from Labonte.
Let's go to Harry Gant's pits.
Harry Gant has been in the pits, Ken, for more than a lap now. He has ignition problems on his car number 47. He was one of the fastest cars out there charging to the front. The crew said all of a sudden it started misfiring. They brought him in. He went back out, only made a lap, and now they're changing distributors on the car. So he's losing a lot of valuable time here.
I can't imagine what it must be like to be in a race and lose time. It must be very frustrating.
The old lap charters keeping very careful track as Bonnet puts the Ford back in front. The Pontiac continues to run in second place. Ricky Rudd in car number 88 maintaining the third position, running with an Oldsmobile. And now Benny Parsons, as you see, a lap car, appears in third, but he is a lap down, and the report is that number one, 81, keeps swapping.
Number one, Buddy Baker's lying in fourth at the moment, closely followed by our man, Labonte, number 44. Now it looks like Darrell Walchuk slipped into that position.
There are 10 cars gathered up in the lead draft.
Walchuk must be a lap down.
Coming up on the 40 lap mark in a lap and a half. Back straight away, here comes another pass for the lead. Back goes Bobby Allison, 1978 Daytona 500 champion, in front of Neil Bonnet. Unrelenting, Allison surges back in front. Number 19, Sanders, is back on pit road at this time.
Ken, I'm down here on pit row with J.C. Elder, the crew chief on Ricky Rudd's car. He's kind of relaxing a little bit back against the stack of tires away from the pit wall. But, J.C., I understand that Ricky's got some radio problems. Is that right?
Yeah, we don't have no radio.
What do you do now?
Just got to give him a signal by the pit board.
Like the old days, huh?
Yeah, back the old days.
are you running all right other than that?
Well, right now, yeah.
Okay. Some guarded optimism there, Ken. Back to you.
Well, racing in the old days was fine, except everybody else is racing in the new days. It does make life very difficult if you haven't got good communication.
Running is Baker. Fourth is Rudd. Fifth is Earnhardt. And going in the sixth position is Terry Labonte.
Earnhardt just absolutely squeezed right up to the wall there as they came off the tri-oval. I seem to think coming off this tri-oval today, it's going to be a very tricky position. We've got like a 40-mile-an-hour tailwind, but it is in fact slightly crossed, and it pushes them into the wall as they come off that tri-oval. That's a second really, really close call we've seen in that corner. That was Dale, in fact, getting squeezed out there by Darrell Walchuk, who I think must be a lap down, in fact.
40 laps, that lead group. 40 laps, 100 miles have been completed. Cecil Gordon is pitted at the back of the track. Leaders coming by with Bobby Allison first, Bonnet second, Baker third. Rudd is in fourth, Rudd is fifth, Labonte is in sixth. Pearson is in seventh.
Tagging along at the back of that group, looking all innocent in that orange car as we just see going out of the picture there, is one A.J. Foyt from Houston, Texas. You'll know that he's not a lap down, and he is in the lead group, but he's not a lap far behind the leader. I would keep a close eye on A.J. in this race. His previous winner, there's Richard Petty, number 43, being followed by Cale Yarborough, who's last made some ground up from his lowly 29th starting spot.
One-fifth of the distance completed. With 40 laps in, we'll give you a rundown in just a moment as you're watching live the Daytona 500 here on CBS. This afternoon, $700,000 at stake. And there's Richard Petty moving in on Terry Labonte.
right behind him is Cale Yarborough, who's moved up to ninth spot, so he's moved up 20 places, but he's where he wants to be now. He's in that lead draft. He's still nine cars behind Bobby Allison, but at least he's in touch.
Labonte is sixth, Richard Petty is in seventh, as you looked out the back window of Labonte's car, and Richard Petty, the six-time champion, moving in.
The man controlling this race is definitely Bobby Allison. Look at him going high around three and into four there.
Bobby Allison seeking his second Daytona 500-mile victory as the shadow of 10 other competitors on his rear deck. After 44 laps have been completed, 110 miles, we have had 15 lead changes. That's better than half of what we saw the entire race last year. There were 29 lead changes in the entire 500 a year ago. Already there have been 15 in this race for just a little over 100 miles. Billy Harvey, number 31, is pulling on pit road, scoring some stuff. Also on pit road, Harry Gant another time. Not a good day for the Beatty Johnson combination, the Race Hill Crimes car, and there is Harvey coming in with some problems.
It's a great shame because Harry Gant rode a very good, qualified well, drove a very good qualifying race, and was running very strongly in the early going today. And, well, that's effectively it now. If he gets back now, he must have lost four or five laps.
At 40 laps, 100 miles, the speed was 164.760, way off the record of 180.180 that was established a year ago by Buddy Baker. This is actually has been created by the caution condition on the track. Let's go back to Terry Labonte's car as he continues, and Richard Petty looks like he's moved around him in their struggle. That would put Petty into six. Watching him down the backstretch, Richard Petty has just pulled in front of him, number 43. And there's Labonte, and here's a car pulling up on the inside of him. That's Cale Yarborough shooting down and getting around Terry Labonte. There he is in the upper right of your picture. That's Cale Yarborough. Down the inside, looked like the car was leaning all the way over on the right.
You can see that flurry of activity on Labonte's arms, too. When Yarborough went by, definitely upset the car. Unfortunately, you're seeing a disappointed Labonte coming into the pits.
Labonte is pitting. You're with him as he comes on pit road. Let's check and see if this is an unscheduled stop. And he's going behind the wall. Terry Labonte has had trouble in car number 44. He's been running with the leaders. Oh, it is trouble in car number 23. Has spun off up at turn number 4 up by the tunnel. Car number 23 out of control at turn 4. Jeff Bodine's automobile has finally come to rest. Caution is on the track.
I think he probably spun on Labonte's oil, but he went right into, it seemed like he went right into the crowd somehow. I didn't even know how he could get down there.
Well, those are safety personnel, and we have a replay. We can see exactly what happened. Apparently, there was oil on the track in turn 4. Let's look and see if we can discover what happened here. And there in the top of the picture, you saw some smoke coming off the wheels of car number 23. The Bear car of Bob and Richard Bear from Oxford, Maine, and the car sliding, coming up across the top of the tunnel. People darting, getting out of the way. As those are press photographers up there and safety personnel.
I have never in all my years coming to Daytona seen a car take such an incredible course. Let's obviously hope that no one was injured by the car.
There is Jeff Bodine, now residing in Pleasant Gardens, North Carolina. His dad ran a speedway up in upper New York State for many years. He's been trying to break onto the Grand National Tour. They came down here and qualified very well. A second ambulance has pulled up, and we're waiting for a report, and all the leaders are pitting. We're trying to get a report for you on Terry Labonte. It looks like he just had an engine hand grenade on him up there in turn number 4. It may have laid some oil down, which 23 then got into, and you saw the results. Yeah, here's a pit stop. It is under caution, so they won't be working with quite the pressure as they would under green, but it will give you a fair idea. Two tire change, now four tires. They're going all the way around on Bobby Allison's Pontiac.
When they change the tyres like this, Ken, of course, the reason they do it is the new tyres are always just a little bit quicker. They don't have to do it because they're worn out. They don't wear out that quickly. But they do definitely go better. They're having trouble getting out. There's just not room for it to get out.
Goes around, Neil Barnett. Almost had an accident during the parking lot.
Well, there we see the two strongest cars here going out together. And young Stan Barrett was zipping by there in car number 22.
Stan Barrett in his first Daytona 500, driving for his new team. Travis Carter is the crew chief. Remember the years that Travis worked with the Junior Johnson people, hoping to put a team together that will really be starred out here in time to come. More on this accident and on the bounty in a moment. Miles have been completed in the 23rd Daytona 500. Caution came out. It appears that Terry Labonte blew an engine and car number 23 went into the oil, spun, and did a most unusual thing. It went off we've never seen before. David Hobbs.
I can't believe it. It was coming around turn four. It must have hit the oil, spun down to the infield, which is the normal course of events. And then unfortunately, the car just seems to take right over, climbs the safety bank, like a off-road car, and just disappears into that crowd of photographers and officials.
People diving out of the way, the car going over the bank and right up against the wall. Now those are press photographers and safety personnel who were there. We're still waiting for a further report. The initial report is that Bodine is all right. We're waiting to know if there is anything else that of consequence that has happened in this incident at turn four. Some of the folks checking their program here, as indeed they need to with all these driver changes this year among the top competitors, under caution for the second time. It's really relatively simple as far as these driver changes. Rudd replaces Waltrip, who replaces Yarborough, who replaces Parsons, who replaces Allison, who replaces Baker, who replaces Pearson, who replaces Chuck Baum, who is still home looking for a ride.
Simple. I can't imagine what all the fuss is about. But that was the most freaky accident I've ever seen here. And he just disappeared more or less into the tunnel, which is the infield entry exit. We've got one lap to go under the yellow. The pace car light will go out on this time round.
Earnhardt is in front. The Stan Barrett car is behind it, but that is a lap car. And the second place car would be Allison. The third place car on the field is 21 Bonnet. Then the fourth place car would be Richard Petty. Fifth place would be Ricky Rudd.
Ricky Rudd, of course, is one of the driver changes we just mentioned. He's driving Darrell's old 88.
Six is Cale Yarborough, and running seventh on the field was Buddy Baker. Getting set for a start. We have completed 53 of the 200 laps. 132.5 miles are down. Windshields have been an issue today. We had a hole in the windshield of Buddy Baker's car. They black flagged Glenn Jarrett with a cracked windshield. The Whittingtons had a windshield go down on them, as did Ronnie Thomas, and Dave Marcus's number 71 also had a windshield problem. So that seems to be shades of what, 1964? 66, when they had windshield problems here.
It's pretty unusual because NASCAR make a tremendous effort to make sure the track is clean and safe after any incidents, and they like to keep it very clean.
We have a report that no one was injured in the incident with the Bear number 23 being driven by Jeff Bodine, the car being towed back, but the driver and the working press up there are all right, as well as the safety personnel, and that is good news.
Well, it's always good news when no one's hurt in one of these racing crashes, and that's another thing about NASCAR. It is very safe, and here we see the cars coming around three and four on their way to take the green.
There you see the Burt Reynolds Hal Needham car on the inside, lapped automobile, Stan Barrett, and on the outside is car number two. Stanley has been with us as a commentator several times at CBS. Very nervous this morning.
His adrenaline will be flowing now. He's at the lead, right at the lead of that field. Look at what's lined up behind him.
As they come down to start, first position car is Earnhardt. Second is Bobby Allison. Third, Bonnet. Fourth, Petty. Fifth is Rudd. Then comes Cale Yarborough, followed by Buddy Baker. And the field assembles in turn number one for some high-speed racing.
Yarborough pulling himself up now. riding spot. There's never a man to discount in this Daytona 500. Surprise, surprise. Look who's at the front of that lead craft.
Look at that water on the inside of the back straightaway. Everybody slides off in there. It rained all night, hard. Rained yesterday and canceled the Sportsman 300. It was not run. Rained all day, so if they get off the track, they're really in the soup here today. Coming by to complete lap 55. In car number 21, Neil Abbott. Hot on the trail of Bobby Allison. That is exactly where he wants to be. Before the start of the race, we asked Neil about his early race strategy.
It looks like it's going to be a strategy to hook on the back of that, back end of that little black and silver car of Bobby's. His car is just running so good, and I could draft with him the other day. It was a pretty good handful, but it looks like Bobby's going to be the guy to throw it.
Side by side, Neil Bonnet and his teacher, Bobby Allison, out Bonnet out in front as he scoots through the third and fourth turn. Earnhardt drops third, going back to the third spot. As they come back to the line, it's Dale Earnhardt in the fourth position. Ricky Rudd, the lap car, Benny Parsons in between. Let's go to Ned Jarrett.
The CBS camera is out of it. Terry, what went wrong with your car number 44?
Ned, the car developed a vibration about 10 laps before whatever broke. And, you know, I really don't know what happened to it. I believe it was something in the engine.
You were giving us some great pictures out there. We're sorry to see you out of it.
I'm sorry to see myself out, too.
Well, I know you are, but you are okay.
Yeah.
Well, and a fellow that was a victim of that when he dropped the oil was Jeff Bodine. Jeff, did you hit the oil?
Well, number seven, so Bruce Hill has crashed.
Behind Daryl and...
number seven, Topeka, sideways. Kansas, Bruce Hill has crashed. The car is resting against the wall. We have another caution.
Well, he's resting against the wall. Well, I wouldn't want to hope it. Race back to the flag, yeah, because that's a tricky situation in NASCAR racing, and they'll see him park there against the wall on the exit of turn two.
Lap number 55, just before the caution came out, was run at an average speed of 190.275. That was 190.275. We've just had a flag for the third caution of the day as Bruce Hill in trouble. Car resting just as they exit turn number two. We'll get back to Ned Jarrett with Jeff Bodine in just a moment. We're trying to see what happened here. He's already in the wall. Looks like he just danced up into the thing.
Well, of course, and he's doing the correct thing. Once you're in that wall in NASCAR racing, you've absolutely got to stay there, because the worst thing you can do, come away from the wall, get side onto the traffic, and get T-boned.
Waiting for some assistance here, Bruce Hill, former Rookie of the Year. And let's go back to Ned Jarrett.
One of the hottest modified drivers in the country is Jeff Bodine, and he was a victim of the engine that blew on Terry Labonte's car. Jeff, describe what happened.
Well, I was following Daryl, and he was smoking a little bit. That concerned me. I was afraid he might blow up, but I never saw Terry blow the engine, and I went in the corner a little low, and the car just went sideways. I got it down, kept it off the wall. I got it down in the grass, and from there it just drove itself. You know, you get in the grass, you can't drive these cars, and fortunately, we didn't run into anybody or anything else.
You just sit there and sort of hang on.
Well, it was a wild ride. I came up over the bank by the tunnel, and there were some people standing there. That looked pretty bad for a while, but they all got out of the way.
Jeff, how was the car handling? There'd been so much talk all week long about these cars.
We were handling well. We were down on horsepower. We changed the engines from the 125, and it just didn't have the horsepower, and I couldn't stay in that lead draft, but the car was handling well.
Ken, here's a fellow that wants to do this so badly and get to the top. He's made it to the top in the short track division, and now he wants to do it in this tough Grand National division.
Jeff Bodine, car built by Tom Pistone, that looked very, very strong, came out here today having trouble. Aerodynamics play such a big part of this Daytona 500. And earlier we took a look at what happens in a draft. Here's a very special report from Ned Jarrett on drafting.
Most television viewers have heard the word drafting used when they're viewing a NASCAR race. Here at Daytona or any of the other high-speed racetracks, it's a very integral part. When you have two or more cars running together, they can run faster than one car running by itself. Since the draft is invisible, we went to Atlanta to Lockheed to try to demonstrate to you how it works. With the use of smoke to simulate airflow with model cars, you see how the air is broken apart in the frontal area of the car, some going above the car, some below it.
The air flows across the car and is broken up to a degree by the spoiler on the rear deck lid. But when one car is running by itself, this air rushes back together and creates a vacuum which has a tendency to pull back on the front car. Aerodynamic experts have calculated that at 55 miles per hour, 50% of the horsepower is used just to overcome wind resistance. As you see, the second place car begins to get benefits from the air broken up by the first car. The model shows what appears to be a turbulence from the first car, but the turbulence should not be mistaken as bad in all cases. Actually, the air is thinner, which lets the second car take advantage of the draft. As the driver of the second car approaches the first car, he feels himself being pulled forward at a faster rate than normal. As he enters the vacuum, the air begins to smooth out for both cars. The front car is being helped because the air is not closing back together immediately behind him. The two cars are only affecting the air once. As the second car gets to the optimum position, that is, as close as he can run, both cars are getting the maximum effect of the draft. In this position, the second place car might only have to accelerate half throttle to keep up. He's running in such thin air, it doesn't take nearly as much horsepower. The second car can't stay there too long, though, due to not getting enough air to cool the engine. When the cars are running this close together, the principle is basically the same as when one car is running alone. The vacuum is being created at the rear of the second car. The benefits of the draft, as demonstrated so far, are not limited to just two cars. The same principles apply to a third car that might join the draft. As the third car joins the draft, the air begins to smooth out over all three, which permits them all to go faster. The lead car is the workhorse and is expending more energy. One of the interesting techniques in drafting is slingshotting. Many times you will see a car pull out and pass with a burst of speed, and it looks like he has suddenly generated an extra 100 horsepower. But actually, he has not had to use all of his horsepower while running in the draft. He can build up momentum in the slipstream and shoot past the first place car. There's another aspect to how the air is affected when the run speeds like we're seeing here today. As we look at the airflow from the top of the cars, we see a thick wall of air pushed out on each side. As the car goes around the turns, it actually leans on the wall of air to keep it stable. An inexperienced driver can get in a lot of trouble by getting too high, particularly when he starts off of a turn in the draft. In the 125-mile qualifying races, Bobby Allison, which is the second car in the picture, was leading the race. Neil Bonnet in the red and white car was running second, and he's in the correct position drafting off Allison. He's about a half a car width below Allison, which puts him in thick air, and that stabilizes his car. But John Anderson in the orange car was running too high as he came off of the turn and was in thin air to begin with. But then he got into the turbulent air off the front two cars, and it literally sucked the back end of his car around, put him out of control. The other cars, of course, pull away, but here is Anderson now, and you can see the end result when he gets in trouble.
We are back live with you at Daytona. Again, that happened on Thursday, that crash of John Anderson. He is all right. He's up here watching yesterday, or hopefully watching a race that was washed out. And with two laps down, half under green, we are at the 61st lap. There's Don Whittington, number 93, trying to make up a lap and get back in the lead lap. The Florida driver, Bobby Allison in front, Dale Earnhardt in second, Ricky Rudd in third, Sonny Baker is maintaining fourth, Richard Petty is showing in the fifth position as they come by. In the sixth position is Kaylee Arbour. In seventh is David Pearson. Running eighth is Ricky Rudd.
Well, now watch out for fireworks now. We got Don Whittington leading this lead car drive. Bobby Allison's heart, no doubt, right in his mouth. Don Whittington's already a lap down. The only reason it's a lap down is because the windscreen broke, and we've got a report that car number 71, that's Dave Marcus, and 24, Cecil Gordon, also have broken windshields, but they're not severe enough to take them off the track.
Bill Elliott is running in ninth as you look at the front of the field, and running in tenth is Donnie Allison, with A.J. Foyt maintaining 11th. In the 12th position is Jody Ridley. Going 13th on the field is Lenny Pond. 14th overall is Johnny Rutherford, and 15th is currently number 75, Joe Milliken. The 16th car is an error on this rundown. They're reporting that, and that may be correct, but Bonnet back that far after that restart. Bonnet back to 16th with the 17th position, as Bonnet pitted and came in on the tail end of the lead lap. The 17th position is the 41, Richard Brooks, with the 18th position, Elliott Forbes Robinson. And Jeff Bodine is coming back on the track. The car that spun off in turn number four, Bodine, number 23, once again is on the racetrack. Jeff Bodine in a Pontiac, trying to get back in this thing, coming up to speed.
He lost a couple of laps there while he had a lunch break down with the marshals at the tunnel entrance.
64 laps, now complete. Speed very slow, 151.388 miles per hour. The record at this juncture is Richard Petty's at 179 miles an hour. Taking a look at the attrition, Blackie Wengren crashing in lap 19. Cecil Gordon is out. Terry Labonte has lost an engine. He has retired from the event. Those are the three first official retirees, leaving 39 cars still in action as we get to lap 65 when they motor by this time. Everyone 1 year ago on the NASCAR Grand National Tour.
Rookie of the year, before, and then the first time a rookie has gone straight to the National Championship. And also a record amount of money, $588,000 winning last year.
Cecil Gordon has just come back on the track. It had been reported that he had retired from the event. Cecil Gordon has now brought his number 24 yellow and blue car back on the racetrack. Here's Allison, in his 67th lap. Bobby Allison first came here in 1961 to race at Daytona. He won his first Grand National race in the state of Maine back in 1966 and went on to two other victories at Islip, Long Island, and Beltsville, Maryland that year. Little old Chevy number two, which made a lot of history because at that time, Chevrolet hadn't been winning many races. But Allison turned that around and now has won himself 61 Grand National races. Keeping track of those times per lap as they come by. Last lap was 190.799 miles per hour on the lead car, Bobby Allison in number 28. So they, from the grandstands, from the $55 seats, my friends. Third spot, Baker. Fourth spot, Ricky Rudd. Fifth spot, Petty. Petty running very well here. Remember, he was injured a year ago, that number 43. Neil Bonnet moves in on number 27. Bonnet, moving all the way up quickly through traffic, is now challenging back in the seventh position.
Taking on Cale Yarborough. And that's drafting down the inside. He's probably going to have a go at Richard, too, as they go into turn three.
Made a heck of a run. He's passed eight automobiles, and he's pulling himself up to take a shot at Richard Petty. That Ford is really working today. So in the, just running back into traffic.
Slips back into the ground.
Allison first. Earnhardt second. Ricky Rudd third and all the way up to fourth and still challenging. Here comes 21 Neil Bonnet. Boy, he'll have this Ford crowd on their feet. There's Baker riding in the third with his Oldsmobile. Pontiac out in front. Earnhardt rides in second. There's Baker going down to the inside to challenge for the lead. And here comes Bonnet. He was all the way back. He's being shown in the 16th position about 5 laps ago. And he's thundered right back up with the leaders.
Tremendous judgment calls are required when you pull back into that draft like he, we saw him do on the lap before. When they pull out like he is now, down low, then he slips back in like that. You've got to really make sure that the gap is there.
One car getting soon for him. Come in. There is Cale Yarborough getting under Earnhardt in the 27 as they go back in that 1600 foot straightaway down to turn number one. Jeff Bodine on pit road. Jeff Bodine back in, change of right side tires on that machine. Meanwhile, the leader's going down the back straightaway. And here's a battle for the lead another time. Buddy Baker is on the inside. Oldsmobile against Pontiac. Ford comes down the inside. All the mix looking good out here thus far in the going. Cars very skitterish, but the driver's doing magnificently.
Cale Yarborough underneath Bobby Allison there as well.
but he's going to have to slip back into that draft, or he could drop back about six places.
80 laps complete. Baker going in front. Now Bonnet comes back up for the lead. Allison riding in third. Earnhardt back to fourth. Kaley Armour fifth. Ricky Rudd in the sixth position. Following Ricky Rudd, David Pearson holds on to seventh. Eddie has slipped back to the eighth. Ninth position is Elliott, and up to tenth comes A.J. Foyt. He's picked up one. There's Waltrip running a lap down on the field. He's had some problems out here today. The latest report showed him back in the lead lap.
He probably got back in the lead lap on that last shuffle in the finish of the last course in fact.
Darrell Waltrip has made up the deficit of one lap and is being shown running now with the leaders.
Devastating lead draft group. You'll notice that today there's very little side-by-side motoring as they go around turns one and two. They draft each other down this back straight into that strong headwind, make a slingshot going into three, and they're prepared to go around three and four side-by-side. They're now in the lead of the win.
Once again, Bobby Allison goes down the inside and zips into first place in the 72nd lap of the Daytona 500. Lenny Pond, 13th is Donnie Allison. Going in the 14th position is Richard Brooks, doing very well out here today. Elliott Forbes Robinson is running 15th, and going 16th is Johnny Rutherford. A.J. Foyt is in 10th, and here's A.J. getting by the lap car, the Bud Moore car, number 15, being driven by Benny Parsons. The last lap by the leader, number 28, Bobby Allison, at an average speed of 189.155 miles per hour. And here come your leaders at just under 190, and they're fighting 40-mile-an-hour headwinds down the back straightaway. You can see how stiffly the flags are blowing today. A lot of starch in them from the wind, and it has canceled out our Goodyear blimp shots, which we've always had in the past. The Goodyear blimp has been grounded by the turbulent weather that we have above us, as well as off the banking of the speedway.
And there's a cool 13 cars in that lead draft at the moment, currently led by Neil Bonnet, closely followed by Bobby Allison, who takes another stab at him at the end of that back straight.
Neil Bonnet seeking his eighth Grand National victory, would be his first Daytona 500 win. And as we mentioned earlier, it will be the fifth time that the Wood Brothers have taken that beautiful maroon, white, and gold livery of Paul Cameron into victory lane here at the Daytona Speedway. Let's follow them around 360 degrees. This will make you hold your breath. There they go, down that 3,500-foot back chute. There goes Allison up on the inside. Allison back in front as they hit turn three. Donnie Allison in the pits. Car number 12 on pit road and continuing to follow around 360 degrees. Here they are down that grandstand out of turn number four, helping them with the wind. Here they are into the tri-oval. Now they bear down on the fastest part of the track, the wind directly at their tail and just pushing them down into turn number one.
Probably doing over 200 miles an hour at that point as they go into turn one.
Then how do they slow down if they're running wide open here?
They don't slow down.
But the average speed, 185 miles an hour.
Unfortunately, going down this straight that we see them coming onto now, the back straight, they'll be pushed down to about 195. And of course, they lose speed in the corners even if they don't have to lift off.
The G-forces just load up on these cars. There's so much weight from the G-force that they lose a lot of speed in the banking.
Tremendous amount of tire scrub. And it wears off speed, as we saw from our in-camera picture earlier. Labonte losing about 500 RPM, which with the gear they have is a lot of miles an hour.
Execute executing very well out here today for the kind of conditions they have to run with and the squirrely cars, these narrower, shorter machines. They're driving well, but look at this field stay together. Keep the pressure on.
Well, of course, that's what they're doing. They're staying together. We're not seeing anything like as much side-by-side driving as we used to. And these guys are just making sure they're hanging in there in that draft. There's no point in knocking your brains out at this stage in the race. It's the last 10 laps that count. Well, it's the last lap that counts.
The leader, Bobby Allison, in lap traffic and just one car length adrift in second place, Neil Bonnet. Really windy out here today. Here they are, back to the tri-oval. And look at this, a kimball of automobiles back into turn number one.
Passing a whole bunch of lap traffic there, this incredibly high-speed line of drivers going around the outside of the slower cars. This is when everybody's holding their breath.
Bobby Allison first, Bonnet in second, Baker is third, Earnhardt is fourth. Donnie Allison is back in the pits. In the pit spot, Ricky Rudd. Six is Cale Yarborough, brother David Pearson. Then comes Richard Petty, Darrell Waltrip, holding on to the next position back as they come off the banking. We have an 11-car draft for the lead. Back to the line. Allison first, Bonnet in second, Baker right there in third, still in the fourth position. A shootout, this could be at the finish. Dale Earnhardt holding on to fourth. The leaders now in their 82nd lap of the 200 in today's Daytona 500. We'll continue with more live coverage of the Daytona 500 after this word from your local stations. Back with you in the 83rd lap here at the Daytona International Speedway with David Hobbs, I'm Ken Squire. Rock Yates along and Ned Jarrett on pit road. 207 miles have been completed. Again, back and forth between the Alabama gang. Neil Bonnet scoots down the inside and reaffirms that front position for the Wood Brothers. And the average speed, lap 70 to 80. In that 10 laps, between lap 70 to 80, they averaged 188.679 miles per hour. There's the average speed of the race, down to 159.151.
There's somebody that's not enjoying the race quite as much as we are. These guys out here averaging 188 miles an hour. There's a cool 1.5 seconds covering the first 13 cars. Now, if that's not close racing, I don't know what it is.
Buddy Arrington being overlapped. Number 99, Tim Richmond, is on pit row. Leaders working the 85th of 200 laps. Bonnet back in first. Bobby Allison in second. Baker in third. Earnhardt is fourth. Riding in fifth is Cale Yarborough. Ricky Rudd is sixth. Richard Petty is in seventh as they come down on the third floor.
David Pearson, I think, is in eighth. And following pretty closely behind David Pearson is Darrell Waltrip, followed very closely by A.J. Foyt, number 51. Waltrip's car is still smoking.
10th place is A.J. 11th place, Elliott. 12th place, Jody Ridley. 13th, Lenny Pond. 14th, Elliott Forbes Robinson. 15th, Richard Brooks. Changing lead another time. Allison going back in front. Still 21 cars in the lead lap.
Elliott Forbes Robinson, number 86, lying there in 14th spot. We'll be pretty happy with that so far. He was the highest rookie scorer at Riverside 3 weeks ago. And here we see another shot from the spectator I knew right there in the grandstand.
Joe Milliken is running in 16th position with his number 75 for his fans around the country. Car number 17, pulling on pit road. This is the Roger Hamby-owned car, which Glenn Jarrett, the son of Ned Jarrett, is driving today. A rookie here at the Daytona 500, a Buick automobile, number 17. And here we see the leaders once again, down the back straightaway. Not much room between those competitors as they go down the back stretch. Let's get a mid-race pit report from Brock Yates.
Ken, nothing is done frivolously here in the Winston Cup racing, and the choice of pits at Daytona is a very, very interesting aspect of the strategy to go into this competition. As you know, there are 60 pits that run up and down this nearly quarter of a mile pit lane, and the choice of those positions are very carefully determined by the competitors. For example, I'm well up near turn one, and I'm being flanked by the Bobby Ellison pit on one side of me and the Glenn Wood, Neil Bonnet pit just on the other side of me. They've chosen this pit for a reason, or these two pits for a reason. I'm standing in a driveway between them, which gives them some extra space when the cars come in and out of the pits. They get very congested. Oftentimes, on a caution, everybody comes in at once. Ironically, even though they had a lot of space here, on the second pit stop, Neil Bonnet car nearly blocked Bobby Ellison as he tried to get out of the pit. But it's still a useful place to be because it can come all the way down this big pit lane off turn four, get full bore, jump in here, and presumably get out a little bit quicker. But other people like to think the other end of the pit is a better place to be, and Glenn Jarrett's down there to tell us about that.
We're in the pit area that's nearest to the fourth turn. The Petty's, we're standing between the Kyle Petty and the Richard Petty pits. They are in a similar situation to what you were describing, Brock, with the space between them. That gives them more room to operate. But they like to be on this end because they like for the driver to get slowed down, and then after he has made his pit stop, he has a lot of room to accelerate to the other end of pit road, and once he hits that banking in the first turn, then he has a lot of speed up. So the pits are chosen by, first of all, the Grand National Champion gets his first choice. And then it goes according to the time trials or according to the start on the grid as to how they choose. Everybody has a different reason, and it's always interesting to see why.
Jarrett, Ed Jarrett?
Yes.
Aren't we getting very close to some pit stops under green?
As you can probably see on the rear of my camera, Ken, that there's action in the Petty pits. It's not quite time for a stop. They're seeing about 5 laps, but we'll keep our eyes on it. It should be coming up very shortly.
A.J. Foyt is pitting right now under green. Foyt, the 10th place runner, is in. Bill Elliott, who's been swapping 10th place with him, he has just pitted and come back on. The front nine should be pitting in the next 5 or 6 laps. There is A.J. Foyt's car, the all-time Indianapolis car champion, 4 times a winner, and he comes back on the track. Jeff Bodine's number 23 is back on pit road for additional work, and the left side of the car is up. Number 41, Richard Brooks, is also pitted. Are back in turn number one. Number 9, Jody Ridley is now car. Jody Ridley, the 12th place car, also just pitting. Tommy Gale has come in. Oh, we have trouble on number 27. Terry Armour looks like he's cut a tire down. He is sliding. That's a bad break for Gale. It is a tremendous advantage for all the other competitors because right where they needed a caution flag, David Hobbs, Cale Yarborough gives them one.
It's also an incredibly bad break for A.J. Foyt because he's just stopped on the green and he could lose a lap in a situation like this. I'll tell you, one of the other hard luck stories out there is young number 47,
Harry Gant.
Who was running with Lenny Pond and Don Whittington, and he just drove away from them and was making ground up very fast, entirely on his own, no draft to help him, running very strongly, but of course, as we saw, he lost about 4 or 5 laps earlier on, so he really doesn't have much chance.
That is the fourth caution of the day. It comes in the 90th lap. Let's look at replay as to what happened to the two-time Indy 500 champion, the lead car in this picture coming up, number 27.
Okay, going to turn two, and he suddenly, the front end gets away from him, he swerves up, just touches the bank, comes down on
Pearson.
Pearson. Incredible piece of driving there from David Pearson, because he got touched quite hard by Cale as he came down off the bank. It looks as if the right front tire went because his car just took a tremendous set up to the right. There's Darrell
Petty's getting ready to pit. Ned Jarrett standing by.
Ken, they were ready to come in with the car number 43 just as the caution came out. And as you and David mentioned, a break here for those who had not pitted. Now they'll get to do it under caution. And for the fans that might not understand the NASCAR rules, of course, they can pit anytime under caution. And as a result of the pace car running much slower than the race cars run under the green, they can do it more leisurely. However, as you see the Petty crew go to work, they are among the best in the business. In fact, they won a pit crew championship not too long ago. With the work that they do, they're changing the right side tires. You can see they're cleaning the windshield.
cleaning the front screen or giving Richard something to drink. But there's a lot that goes on during a pit stop, and you even see some of the crew members working on the rear spoiler of this car. Apparently the car is not handling exactly the way Richard wanted it to handle. So they're taking this opportunity under the caution to make those adjustments. And you can see Richard sort of adjusting traffic as they come around and change the left side too. So they change four tires, put in 22 gallons of gasoline, and all else. And now let's go to Brock Yates.
I'm down here in the tail Yarborough pit. As you can see, the automobile has had some serious damage. The right side front tires were badly stuffed. The right front was flat when they came in. Now they're jacking up the left side. The left rear tire is soft and flat. It certainly hit the wall. The bodywork is scuffed and scraped. Kale has been through some hard times out there. The crew is working furiously. The bodywork is bent. You can see some smoke coming out of the right front of the car. It looks like he's in a heap of trouble. They're going to try to get this thing put back together, but it's going to be a jury rig. A yanking on the front bodywork. Crew Chief David Ibbs is screaming orders from the front of the car. It looks like the spoiler's been bent. Now the jack comes down. Yeah, underway, but certainly a crippled vehicle.
Frenzied activity on pit road. That's just part of the story. It's an individual battle for so much of the contest, and then it's turned over to six men. Under green, they'll pit these cars, change two tires, put in fuel in 12 to 15 seconds, and send them back out. Hopefully we'll get some pit stops under green and show you the choreography that goes on. There's Kyle Petty. Here's Ned Jarrett.
And he waited another lap until his dad had been pitted, even though, Ken, they have two separate pit crews for the 42 car and the 43 car. They're changing the right side tires, filling it up with gasoline, and now he's down and away.
There is Kale Yarborough's tire. Want to buy a used tire, David?
No, that one could definitely be thrown away. Look at the smoke coming up. That tire running at about 230 degrees Fahrenheit when these cars are running at full sun.
Hold the phone. Car 51, A.J. Foyt, is being black flagged. He is brought in for running the stop sign at the end of pit road. Get ready for a real... There's the black flag out on A.J. I think you ought to send Brock down there. I sure do.
Brock, go and ask A.J. Foyt why he's coming in.
Harold Kinder putting the consultation flag on A.J. Foyt's number 51. There was a warning to Foyt earlier, as you'll recall. Now they say he has run the stop sign at the end of pit road, and they want to have a little chat. That ought to be some chat. There's number 27 back. David Ipps' crew still working on that machine of the 1968 and 77 champion.
Putting up in the bodywork. Of course, they've got plenty of time here in this caution period. This is the time to do any repairs. They'll be inspecting the track up at turn two where he hit the wall and slid down in front of the traffic. David Pearson counts himself extremely fortunate that he wasn't just a few feet further behind.
28 lead changes thus far in the race. That's one more than a year ago, and we are not yet halfway. We are at 94 laps. And here comes Foyt pulling onto pit road. And the NASCAR official, and let's go to Brock Yates.
Hold on, guys. Here comes AJ, and you can be sure he's hot because he's been called in because of this consultation. You can see that AJ is not pleased. He's a fierce competitor, always charging. Certainly doesn't like this kind of a disciplinary action, whatever the cause might be, but he is fuming. A marvelous competitor, one of the greats, a man that simply does not like to sit still. He's shaking his head, chewing gum, AJ screaming, shaking and waving his arms around. A great showman, a great race driver, some people say the greatest of all time. A lot of people will tell you that there is no better, has been no better in the history of this sport than this man right here.
AJ now one lap
chomping
down.
On that gum. What? Up to you, Ken.
AJ, one lap down. They put him back a lap for running the stop sign at the end of pit road. That's some kind of ticket. Now, you see the NASCAR official standing there. Here's perhaps the man that should receive the Purple Heart or some sort of courageous award.
Well, that just shows the real luck of the draw. He made that green flag stop, and then one lap later they had a caution, and I don't know why they stopped him going out of pit lane. Anyway, they're going to dock him a lap.
One lap to go. They'll drop him on the end of the field when they come by. AJ still over there on pit road. Errol Kinder indicating one lap and he'll send them out. AJ Foyt has won 7 Grand National races. And of course, one for the Wood Brothers here in 1972. Cale Yarborough is back on pit road. Number 27. And if we have a chance before a restart, we have. And Foyt's car is now rolling. Foyt's car coming out after accepting the penalty. I would like to see a replay again, and he shakes his fist at the man with the stop sign.
Gosh, I bet he does too. I find some of these NASCAR rules slightly confusing.
If we could see that number 27 again and see the courageous job of driving by David Pearson. Pearson was tagged by the spinning car. Watch again what happens here as these cars get loose at 190 miles per hour.
Cale Yarborough comes up, tags the wall. As he comes off the wall, David Pearson steers away. But they touch quite hard there. It swings Pearson's car around a little bit, but he keeps control and manages to hang on to the piece of iron. Down at the bottom there, we see another car. But meanwhile, Cale Yarborough just slides around. Luckily, made no real hard contact with anything.
Might have been Ricky Rudd at the bottom of your picture. But that just shows you what a great driver Pearson is. A driver with not that much experience would have sent that car spinning, skittering, out of control. Johnny Rutherford on pit road.
Cale Yarborough also did a pretty good job. He really had a fairly mild spin considering the speed.
Getting ready
for
green.
The tire's gone.
Rutherford still on pit road. He's going to go a lap down. The man who came here with the fastest car back in 1963 reported as a crutch problem. Underway. The longest anyone has led this race, Bobby Allison for 12 laps. As we get back underway, we understand a lot of folks would like us to get reports further back in the field. We're getting reports as far back as they're being given to us from official scoring. On this restart, Bill Elliott has the lead after the pit stops. Elliott, one of those cars in the lead lap in front, but only for a moment. Here's Bobby Allison again going back in front. Neil Bonnet back into second. Position those two have favored all afternoon. Dale Earnhardt into third, and Richard Petty stays in striking distance with number 43. Bill Elliott is fifth. Coming by to complete lap number 98 of 200. The sixth place car, number one, Buddy Baker.
Well, Richard Petty has done less complaining than most drivers this week about the new downsized cars and about the handling of his car. And it's very significant to see him so close to the lead at this halfway stage of the race. And obviously, a six-time winner of this race can never be discounted.
Baker in sixth, running seventh in the back straightaway. Officially, Williams got half down, so we move up into seventh, Ricky Wright. Going to eighth is Donnie Allison. He is in a second pack of cars. There's your first pack. There's the second pack, and there you see Donnie Allison just back behind that lead car. In the second pack, Donnie Allison begins to look good in the Kenny Childers car. He's running right behind Ricky Rudd. Back with the leaders. Bobby Allison on the point. Richard Petty is in the lead lap battling, but not out in front, halfway. Over for two blocks to go home. Let's see what's going to happen today. Here he is. Such stout competition, though. There are so many good cars still out here running so well as we move into the halfway point. One more lap, and they will be halfway in the Daytona 500 running.
Well, it certainly is a vintage year. We have so many competitive cars now. There's more sponsors than ever in this sport, and there's more new up-and-coming young drivers. People like Ricky Rudd driving really good cars. Terry Labonte, who's been coming on so strong. We've got a really, really strong field this year.
Dale Earnhardt's mother watching number two. his dad, one of the all-time short track greats, the late Walter out of the Carolinas. Dale at the victory dinner said the other night, I'm sure my dad is watching somewhere, and I think he'd be very pleased. I think everybody in racing feels the same way. What a tiger this guy at number two is.
Well, you had a report that number 11, that's Darryl Waltrip's car, had sparks coming out from the right rear on the 31-degree banks.
Halfway in the race. 250 miles to go. I can't recall. Recently, we've had so many cars in the lead lap at the halfway point. We'll check that in the record book for you. The race is being very well driven. Kelly Armour having a tire go down. David Pearson again showing you why he is one of the great masters of the game. Not losing control, even though he was coming at high speed. And remember, the speeds are going. These cars weigh only a pound or two, right? I mean, they'll float like soap, like leaves out there if they're touched. And there goes Bobby Allison. Talk about a guy who loves to race. And there he is with Neil Bonnett, the kid who used to sweep out the floor in Allison's garage. Allison brought Neil Bonnett along, and now they're struggling through this race, battling for supremacy.
I heard he still swept it out.
You see, Dale Earnhardt in third, Buddy Baker in fourth, Richard Petty in fifth, as the summit meeting of the Giants continues here at Daytona. Still another time as the lead seesaws in the 23rd run into the Daytona 500. Baker, last year's champion of the 500, is back in first place. Neil Bonnett in second. Bobby Allison in third. Waltrip being shown in the... has dropped out of the sixth in that record. They continue to swap these positions, seesaw from one lap to the next. Let me give you 100 lap, 250-mile halfway rundown. They were averaging 156.631 miles per hour. Nowhere near the record of 173.5111 by Buddy Baker a year ago. A report on Waltrip's car. Let's go to Ned Jericho.
Ken, you mentioned you had a report with sparks coming from the car. I talked with Junior Johnson, the owner of the car. He says what is happening, that they're running such a soft setup, and that is softer springs than normal here at Daytona, in order to stabilize the cars, that when it hits some bumps occasionally, that the exhaust pipe would actually hit the pavement. But he says it is not bothering anything, and everything's okay.
At 250 miles, the official rundown at halfway was then Earnhardt first, Allison then second, Petty then third, with the fourth position overall Baker, the fifth position was Elliott, the sixth position on the field was Waltrip, seventh was Rudd, eighth at halfway was Jody Ridley, ninth was David Pearson, tenth was Elliott Forbes Robinson, 11th was Joe Milliken, 12th was Richard Childress, and 13th on the field was number 42, Kyle Petty. In the 14th position, a lap down was car number 27, and that's the car you saw spinning, Cale Yarborough. The 15th position, also a lap down, Denny Parsons. The 16th position, a lap down, and being put a lap down, this is A.J. Foyt. The 17th position rests with Lenny Pond. The 18th position, Dick Brooks, 19th on the field, Bill Elswick, going 20th, Stan Bennett. The 21st position belonging to Johnny Rutherford, two laps down in 22nd position, number 12, Donnie Allison. Then in 23rd was car number 93, Don Whittington, 24th, number 99, Tim Richmond, and 25th was Dave Marcus. Another change of leadership, the Pontiac going back in front of the Ford, and it is Allison in first, Bonnett in second.
And Darryl Waltrip has made a significant move up to third spot. I don't know about sparking, but his car is definitely still smoking, and he's there sandwiched in third spot between the between the Thunderbird, Neil Bonnett, and Buddy Baker, running very strongly in that number one car. Onto the pit road comes Benny Parsons, car number 15.
Two back kicks.
Ken, a
minutes. Ken, it's the middle of a very nasty afternoon for Benny Parsons. He was expecting to do very well in this car. He stopped earlier with a soft tire. That put him a lap back. Now he's got some heating problems. They're adding water. The engine is now being shut down by crew chief Bud Moore. Benny's just kicked the ignition switch off. The hood's down. The race is over for Benny Parsons.
Field coming back in front of the crowd. But not all the crowd. In the midst of the race and all this battle, there's a few folks out there that have some other things to do today.
Well, they want to spend a bit of money. The concession stands here do a roaring business in t-shirts and hats of all their favorite drivers, Darrell Walter, Richard Petty, and all these people to take home these souvenirs from Daytona. There we see Benny Parsons taking home his souvenir of the day, which is unfortunately not as happy for him.
Bud Moore is number 15, being rolled back, still under the lead change. And Bonnet pushes that number 21 back on the point.
Buddy Baker and Darrell Waltrip in fourth and right behind him is Steve Lansdale in car number two.
Then following him is Richard Petty in the sixth position. But now following the seventh, and we have Jimmy Means back on pit road, the Alabama driver, bringing his car in. There's Means' car. They have engine problems on that one. Front of the field goes up into turn number two. Bonnet in command of this race. Second place automobile. Looks like a waiting game. Somebody has a full house. Somebody's trying to draw to it. There's Allison back in front. What a thorn. That number 28 meanders down that back straightaway.
Although we've had a lot of lead changes in this race, it's been a very restrained race in lots of ways. The lead change has mainly been a result of the headwind and the drafting of these cars, the slight instability on the course.
Eight cars continuing to grapple with first position as the field goes down into turn number one. Number 28, Allison still has the advantage with 111 of 200 laps now complete. And you are now in the car of Richard Childress, the number three car coming down pit road. Richard Childress's automobile as we're trying to fire up our second in-camera car. Leader number 28, Allison at turn two. A lot of people said when they came to Daytona, the cars to look for today, David, would be the Fords. And sure enough, that Thunderbird has stuck it out right there on the front of the draft all afternoon.
Well, it has, but the other strong car all the way, of course, has been Bobby Allison. And look where he's been all the race. He and Neil Bonnet seem to be the strongest cars out there. I must say, I feel a bit sorry for Bobby Allison. He came here with a very, very clear advantage. And to his chagrin, the NASCAR officials really made it easier for the other cars. And I think that's why they're keeping up with him as well as they are, quite frankly. If they'd left it as it was when he arrived, I think he'd be long gone.
With 112 laps complete, we still have 13 cars in the lead lap of the Daytona 500. We have now completed 280 miles of competition. And there's Richard Petty, still putting on some pressure. Oh, that's Kyle Petty. Kyle Petty at number 42, and remember, he's running 13th on the field. Back there with him is car number 86, Elliott Forbes Robinson, just in front of him. Well-known sports car driver. The camera car number three is going down. Richard Childress's car being pushed backwards, and that is going to be through for Richard Childress this afternoon. Bad break for Childress, who was off to a great start this year, had run up in front in much of the race at Riverside, California, the Western 500, and here today is retiring in the 113th lap. Bobby Allison stays out in front, still struggling to win his first Daytona 500, or his second Daytona 500, as Neil Bonnet tries to win his first.
This portion of the 1981 Daytona 500 is sponsored by Levi Garrett Chewing Tobacco. That fresh Levi Garrett flavor is always a winner. Lowenbrau, when it's time for the taste of a truly great beer, let it be Lowenbrau. And by STP, STP gas treatment, and STP oil treatment.
117 laps complete. That is that Lassett's having some problems with car number 11 and is slowing down. There you see the Junior Johnson car. The last few laps have been turned consistently at 47.7 seconds, averaging 188.482 miles per hour. One of the favorites for this race is still trying to get back in, and he'll be laps down. Let's get a report right now on Benny Parsons.
Ken DeBroger is still in the car. The Bud Moore crew is replacing the radiator, Ken. Bennett, a little unusual that you'd have a radiator. What happened to it?
I guess something flew up off the racetrack, went through the grill, and into the radiator. Not to hold it.
Boy, this just hasn't been your day.
Definitely hasn't. Not today.
Bennett, why are you staying in the car?
Well, we're going back out, so it shouldn't take more than three or four more minutes, and I'll be going back down the racetrack.
Of course, they would go back out, of course, to make as many laps as they can and gain as many points as they possibly can, because he will be a contender for the national championship this year.
Six cars running 1 6/10 of a second apart here in the Daytona 500 for the lead. All of a sudden, popping out in the last lap, Allison is pulling away, number 28. Just flat left, number 21, Bonnet, has pitted. His partner through most of the race, Neil Bonnet, is now on pit road. Is this an unscheduled stop is the question here. Here's number 21 in. 11, Waltrip has gone to the garage.
This must be an unscheduled stop for Bonnet. I can't imagine they've done enough laps yet to want to come in again. Not all that long since we last had a caution. Changed the right side tyres, obviously filled it up with fuel. And away he goes, laying some tyre smoke. Treading in those rear tyres. Ned Jarrett said earlier that Benny Parsons is going to be a contender for the championship. He certainly will, because those Fords are running extremely well this year.
Let's go to Ned Jarrett.
They just pulled the car number 11 into the garage. Now what went wrong?
I don't know, Ned. And blew up.
Oh, so it was the engine then?
Yeah, I don't know what it was. We just really got the car where I could drive it, where it felt pretty good, and I just started to try to go for the lead the first time all day, and something happened to it. I'm not sure what.
Now, when you say you just got in the car to where you could drive it, were they making adjustments on it?
Yeah, we were changing the wedge around in the car on every pit stop, and we just finally hit it on that last one, and you know, the guys were doing a great job, and we were about to overcome the problems we were having, and I was beginning to feel comfortable, and then something happened.
Well, you've had a lot of success here at Daytona up until right now. You've taken, I think, about $87,000 or $88,000 away from here before this race started today.
Well, we were hoping to do well today, Ned, just for the national championship. You know, the points are today, and they haven't the other races paid any points, so it really put us behind the eight ball. We fell out at Riverside, and we're out here again today, but I know Junior and all this Mountain Dew bunch will come back real well.
So your first Daytona 500 win is still somewhere else?
Yeah, it is. I hope maybe next year.
God. Well, I'll tell you, Ken, it's awfully hard for a fellow to smile under this kind of circumstance, but he managed one.
Distressing time for Darrell Waltrip, having to fall out in the 118th lap of the 23rd Daytona 500.
Covering up intense disappointment there, like the true racer he is, put on a tremendous display this afternoon. An absolutely violent disappointment for us.
The action continues to swirl around Bobby Allison and his Pontiac. It stays in first place. Now the second place car has been reported as car number one. The vacancy trying to make a run for it here today, but nobody at this point seems to be able to stay with it. He may be able to run by his lonesome.
Well, we saw that in the qualifying race, and he is in fact putting quite a lot of daylight between himself and Buddy Baker in car number one. The only thing is, this stage in the race, is how is Neil Bonnet going to drag himself up through that multiple car draft? If he can catch up with him again, he's the only man here that can really stay with him. Allison pulling away. That bunch of cars. Getting some slower cars now between himself and the hounding mob behind him, led by Buddy Baker, who's also put a bit of distance between himself and Ricky Rupp.
Foyt slowing down, coming on the pit road, retiring. A.J. Foyt is out of it. A.J. Foyt going back to the garage area, number 51, has dropped out of the race. Back in a year ago, he had trouble. Early on in the going, there you see him going back around the garage wall. try to get a word.
That sent me down, pal.
Number 28. There he is, Bobby Allison, still in front. Donnie Allison's car, number 12, is on pit road. He is two laps down. Kenny Childers' car.
They've had a bad day today, too. Donnie Allison, a very strong runner here at Daytona, but this again, another driver whose day it is not.
Slowing down dramatically through the tri-oval, going very slowly into turn one, number 21. Something is amiss with Neil Bonnet's number 21 Good Brothers car. The spoiler is loose on the left rear of number 21 down in turns one and two. Car number 28, Allison, in front. The guy he ran with in the first half of the race is having real problems. There you see the second turn as we await number 21 to come around. Presumably, it will be pitting the next time by. There is number 21 in the back straightaway, well off the pace.
Oh, you can see the spoiler on the left side of the trunk lid seems to have come off.
It's broken right down.
If there are split spoilers, it looks like the left half has dropped off.
Battle 15, Benny Parsons is going back on the track. Parsons has changed the radiator, and he is returning to the practice. Here is 21 coming in, Bonnet.
Now they've been fiddling about adding the odd half inch, and he's pulling into the garage area.
All of a sudden, just past the halfway mark in the race, the attrition rate continues to climb, and going back to the garage area, Neil Bonnet.
Now all the spoilers. Oh yeah, you see the spoilers lying down on the back there. Well, they've been fiddling around with the odd half inch, so you can imagine what half of the whole spoiler would do for the handling.
There's Ned Jarrett. Walking over to try and get a word with Neil Bonnet. Allison, having trouble. Remember, those two cars running together usually run faster than one car by itself. Down to Ned Jarrett.
This one went wrong.
I was out in the fast lane. I couldn't get in, and the car just virtually shook to pieces. The clutch lever messed up. I was trying to get it in gear going back out, and it's tore the clutch linkage or something off the car, and the clutch is just slipping. The car right now is just shaking all over. When that tire equalized, just about came off the ground, coming off two over there.
Part of your rear spoiler has moved down and is out of place. Did that cause that?
Well, Ned, I don't know. You know, when that tire blew up, the car had been getting a little bit harder to drive. I saw the spoiler down, but the car was just running so good, I didn't know what to do. You know, the Wood Brothers, Pure Lighter. But when that tire equalizer just virtually shook this thing to pieces, I couldn't even see where I was at. And it's just a heck of a note as good as the car was running.
Well, I know your dad watching back home. Sorry to see you out of it here.
Well, Dad, you know, we'll get them next time.
Now back to you, Ken.
And next time for these people comes 1 week from now, where these same stars go to Richmond, Virginia to run on a half-mile track, much like where it all began. The Daytona 500 continues in a moment on CBS. Forbes Robinson and Joe Milliken pit. The cars move into the 132nd lap. They come by next time. They will have completed 330 miles, 68 laps, 170 miles to go. We still have more than 10 cars to lead lap. Breaking away from the field. There you see the distance is Bobby Allison way down into turn number three, and then a tremendous battle for second place. But Allison is beginning to draw away. Waddell Wilson prepared, number 28, running in a solo performance at this time and looking outstanding.
Well, he must have 700 or 800 feet of daylight between him and himself. Buddy Baker here in car number one. And look at that group trying to take away third spot. Ricky Rudd, Richard Petty, Dale Earnhardt.
Ricky Rudd in third, Richard Petty in fourth, Dale Earnhardt in fifth as they exit the tri-oval and running in sixth down on the inside. David Pearson beginning to move in again.
David Pearson, number 16 there. David Pearson, the Silver Fox, also running the only Chevrolet Monte Carlo here. Sort of car that people said wouldn't run at Daytona, but not in the hands of David Pearson. He's right there.
Larry Gaff has pulled on pit road another time. Let's check the attrition. straight for you as Harry Gant comes back on the track. We're up to pit stops under green this time. Eight cars have officially retired from the race. Blackie Wengren crashed early on. He's all right. Blown engine on Terry Labonte. Still wrecked his car. Richard Childress out. The leader is pitting. Daryl Walsh is out. AJ Foyt, Neil Bonham, and Kyle Petty is the latest retiree as we watch Bobby Allison pull on pit road.
And Buddy Baker pulls on right behind him. This is where pit work in NASCAR racing, NASCAR Grand National Racing, is so important.
To Brock Yates.
Suddenly, Buddy Baker's come into the standings here very quickly. I just talked to Haas Ellington to say the car's running very, very well. Buddy's very pleased. The windshield is holding together, and they're in this race.
Indeed they are. There's Allison coming back on the track. This is going to switch the positions around. Ronnie Thomas may be folding up his hand today and stepping away from the table. He started to come out, and now the car is running a miss down on pit road.
Now we have a car stalled in pit road in the fast lane of pit road. That's going to cause trouble.
That's Ronnie Thomas, number 25, having problems with his red and yellow car down here. Ricky Rudd pitting, Dale Earnhardt pitting, and something is amiss on Rudd's car.
Yeah, the rear brake's locked up when he tried to slide into that gap there. These pits are getting pretty congested.
There's the car that's having trouble out there in the fast lane on pit road. At 130 laps, 325 miles, just before the pit stops began, we had seven cars running the lead lap. They were Allison running in first with the second position at that time belonging to Baker. The third position to Rudd, the fourth position Earnhardt, fifth Petty, going sixth was Pearson, seventh was Elliott Forbes Robinson. Eighth, as we watch Petty pitting, was number 90, Jody Ridley, with the 10th position Elliott, the 11th position to Milliken, 12th on the field was Pond, the 11th on the field was Pond, and 12th was Cale Yarborough. 13th, two laps down, was Bill Elswick. 14th was Stan Barrett. There's your new leader, number 16. 15th was Johnny Rutherford, and running 16th was Don Whittington. Now that was at 130 laps, 325 miles, with the average speed at 163.021, not a record. The record 172.540 by Buddy Baker 1 year ago.
And David Pearson heads for the pits.
Pearson, 105 Grand National wins in his career. Won several Firecracker 400s here on the 4th of July. And has picked up one Daytona 500-mile victory. That incredible finish when he and Richard Petty crashed coming out of turn number 4, spun down into the tri-oval, and Pearson limped across the finish down to the grass to win the race with Petty second. The action, look at the side of David Pearson from his brush with Cale Yarborough earlier in that 90-mile-an-hour shot up in turn number 2, and he's still out here. The Silver Fox comes back on the track. Wholesale change of positions. We will continue with more live coverage of the Daytona 500 after this word from your local station. We're back with you live in the 138th of 200 laps. Allison is back in front of the Daytona 500 with the second spot belonging to David Pearson right behind him. And third is Buddy Baker. There's been a switch of positions. Baker has now fallen back, and Pearson is right in the midst of the hunt. Let's go down to the garage area now with Supertex A.J. Foyt.
Ken, we're just about ready to get A.J. to come out. We're standing by with Jim Gilmore here right now. Foyt was ready to come out of the truck, but he's getting his paraphernalia together. He's in the process right now of coming out. Let me just go up and get to him. A.J., what went wrong out there?
Well, actually, Ned, you know, I guess we broke a valve spring. We lost the cylinder there, and I still ain't figured out why they called me back penalized. You know, two of us going out to pits together, David and I, and the guy stopped up and put the sign between us and expect me to stop, I guess.
AJ, how was the car handling out there? There's been so much talk about these cars this week.
Well, actually, mine, 125 miler, Ned, was beautiful. Today, I just had too low of a gear. I think that's what's going to happen. You're going to see a lot more of these cars blow up. They just turn them too tight. I was turning between 76-7700. You can do that for 300 miles, and I run just a little over halfway. And that's one reason I was trying to baby it and still keep up the same time. And we just out-engineered ourselves. We were sitting in pretty good shape, I felt.
Well, Ken, that probably answers the question of why so many cars going out all of a sudden here. Maybe that low gearing turning in those high RPMs, and certainly it will take its toll. The only man to win the Indianapolis 500 four times and also winner of the Daytona 500 here, but he's out at it now.
They reveal the history of this time and years to come. That's the man they're going to be talking about, A.J. Foyt. He won in anything he ever drove. They took him to Le Mans. He did a magnificent job before and go. He's won Indianapolis. He's won here. If you really want to see him at his best, you need to see him in a sprint car or a midget. He was incredible and still is today. And don't forget, when it comes Derby time or Belmont time, you may see A.J. Foyt with a winner there. Loves the Nags. Bill Elswick, number 57, has been black flagged as crew wants him in.
Buddy Baker's round in the leader, Bobby Allison, as they go into turn three and four. High, right up above that lock, that top line. And there's Kelly running a bit further back. Here come the leaders, pounding right behind them as they move through traffic. Back to the tri-oval. And Allison. He had a friend out there as an adversary in the first half of the race. Don't ever get us wrong. Allison was always respect for Neil Bonnet if he didn't run him hard every inch of the way. But they worked a lot together, and I'm sure those two were hoping to break away from the field. James Hilton, Inman, South Carolina, coming on pit road. And here are the leaders on the back straightaway. Lenny Pond, number 68, being lapped by Allison. Pond is doing well. He's up in 11th position at the present time. The leaders pouring through turns three and four. Look at that bump. Now it hits that right front tire. Coming up to lap these slow cars, not quite sure what to do with themselves. Bobby Allison wants to go around the high side, which he does. Baker behind us, and right behind Baker we see Harry Gant. Harry Gant's had some really good laps in today. He's running very strongly, but unfortunately, he has to keep on stopping. And of course, that's no way to win a race.
Baker in second, and there's Kelly Arbor about to go a lap down, and in third spot now. That 47th car is not the official third car. Here's Baker making a move. They're going to go by Arbor inside and outside of the back straightaway.
The meat in the sandwich, as it were. And Buddy Baker takes the lead. And look how high Baker gets, right up to that line and above it.
Breathtaking action here live in the Daytona 500 as Buddy Baker, last year's winner, now driving for Haas Ellington, puts a powerful wheel out in front. Pontiac dropping to second place. The third position overall as they come around is David Pearson. Baker in front. At this stage of the race, the cars begin to loosen up. By that I mean they don't respond as well as they did earlier in the race. Most drivers don't like it. But Baker in car one told us at this stage of the race, it's an advantage.
As the race goes on and the cars are loose, then my chances get better and better because a lot of guys won't ride uncomfortable, and I will.
Well, you can see him use, look at the track he's using up, right up there in that top lane within inches of that wall. And of course, as you said, Buddy Baker likes to really drive these cars. He likes to manhandle them around. The faster the speedway, the better he seems to like it. Here in Talladega are his places. And Harry Gant's right there with him. Harry good, putting on a great show, but unfortunately too far out of it to count.
140 lap rundown, 350 miles complete. They are working lap 145. At that time, Allison was the leader, but Baker second. That now has fluctuated. Third spot, Pearson. Fourth spot, Rudd. Fifth spot, Earnhardt. Sixth spot, Petty. Seventh, Jody Ridley. Then in eighth was Elliott. And running ninth was Milliken. In tenth, a lap down, Elliott Forbes Robinson. And there is Gant getting a lap back from the leaders. Harry Gant moving around, as you see in your picture, in number 47 to get a lap back. The 11th position was being shown as Cale Yarborough. In the 12th position, Lenny Pond. 13th position was Donnie Allison. 14th was Stan Barrett. Going 15th was number 57, Bill Elswick. And 16th was car number 98, John Wolford. That was at 140. The field is now in the 146 lap.
And car number 16, as David Pearson lying in fourth spot, has got smoke coming out of his car.
We'll try to focus on car number 16 here, update that story for you. Here he is on pit road, a lot going on. Number 28, Allison back in front of Baker as they swap it another time.
And young Ricky Rudd and hanging on there very, very well. Ricky Rudd was a rookie of the year in 1977. Driving the Junie Dunlady. He's driven two or three different cars since then. But this is his first year in a really strong car. The driver's beginning to get a little mentally fatigued, physically run down. The wind is just as stout and stiff as it was when the race began. Some 35 to 40 mile an hour gusts, and you get out here and it catches you just right. It'll set you a sail, as it did John Anderson in the 125, and it'll send you on the road to disaster. Right now, Allison trails along behind her again. These two did a lot of short track racing together several years ago. Everywhere you go, you find Harry Gant in a modified car. Now here he is with Allison. Remember, Gant is running a couple of laps back. More than that, Allison running on the point. Buddy Baker looking stronger as the day progresses. We are 137 laps into the Daytona 500. Of the distance has been covered. 125 miles remain. David Pearson's car has retired. Number 16 has gone back to the garage area. Ned Jarrett is with him.
Well, Ned, I guess it dropped a valve or something, because I was running off a good and I started on the backstretch, and all at once I noticed it was slowing down a little bit. Everybody's passing me, and I looked back, and I guess it was water coming out, and Dale Earnhardt was pouring, and by that time a valve went let go.
David, you told me the other day that these cars were the worst that you had seen. Have you changed your mind, or how was it out there today for you?
Well, we changed around, and, you know, NASCAR let us move, get a little bit bigger spoiler. And since we've done that, we got the car where it was working pretty tight.
Looked like you was having fun out there.
Well, I was. Anytime that you're handling good and running good, you're having fun. But when you're not, you don't feel too good.
Had to be thinking you had a good chance to win this thing.
I did. I felt real good. You know, right before that, I come out of the pits, and they had a real good pit stop. The boys, you know, changed tires real fast. And I came out right in front of a Bobby, and I drafted him, and I passed him going on the backstretch. So that made me feel good. I know that at least I could drive by him and win the race.
Well, he wanted to be the third man to win this 500 more than once, but it won't be today, Ken.
Tim Richmond, rookie of the year. Ninth place finisher there in car number 99 for this race has lost an engine, his car being pushed in.
Rookie of the year, Indianapolis.
Last lap at 190.759 miles per hour, and another long walk for Tim Richmond here at Daytona. Allison has the lead. We're in the 153rd lap at the present time, 382 and a half miles. Right behind Allison in that Pontiac comes Buddy Baker.
Allison trying to break the drought there, going right down the apron on that back straight.
Let's check the attrition again at the race. And there you see the first that we have a total of 10 cars officially reported out. Look at Childress Hill. Darrell Waltrip's gone. A.J., Neil Bonnet, Kyle Petty's car is out. But his dad's is on. The latest retirees are Tim Richmond and David Pearson. And notice that Richard Petty is running third behind the Harry Gant car. And he is in this struggle. And as this track gets slipperier, and the seconds continue to tick off toward the finish, that Petty car usually gets tighter and stronger and runs better. Looks like Petty may be a factor in this race. That would be just unbelievable if Petty could ever pull off a 7500. His family, with Lee winning here in 1959 and Pete Hamilton winning here in 1970, 8 wins in this 500. Closest, Cale Yarborough with 2 to that mark. Everybody else has had a solo performance in victory lane. Looks like Benny Parsons is back on pit road, David.
And Benny not having a good day at all, and he's pulling over onto the grass. I think he's decided to make a U-turn on pit road. Well, that's a bit of a dodgy move, I should have thought. Maybe he's decided to take it straight to the garage.
That's just what he's intending to do. I would presume Mr. Gasaway would have a few words about that.
Boy,
150 laps, 375 miles, and here comes Baker on the outside. Buddy Baker's trying to lead again, and it's wheel-to-wheel racing in turns 3 and 4. Allison on the inside, Baker on the outside. averaging in the last lap 190.672 miles per hour. Baker's going out in front. Allison's car looking a little scarce for just a moment there, David.
Yeah, they're all going. You can see them bouncing as they come through that turn four there. Harry Gant still hanging in there. Richard Petty right behind them. And old Ricky Rudd, or young Ricky Rudd in car number 88, is right in there as well. He's just got him at this stage.
And running in the fifth position, number two, Earnhardt.
What a coup that would be for young Ricky Rudd if he was able to win this race. But he's going to have to pass some pretty experienced guys to do it.
Here's Gant trying to get a lap back another time. He is at least two laps down.
He must be a long way now.
At 150 laps, 375 miles, it is an average speed of 165.059, which is far away from Bobby Allison's mark in 1980 of 174.014 at this point of the race. Bobby's brother Donnie has just pitted and come back to the track. The standings, as Gant gets back out in front, 28, Allison is again your leader. Baker is in second. Kenny is in third. Rudd is fourth. Earnhardt fifth. In sixth is Jody Ridley. Seventh is Elliott. A lap down in eighth is Milliken, with ninth position belonging to Elliott Forbes Robinson. Two laps down in tenth is Lenny Kahn. Here's Allison up in front going around again as they sort it out of that, picking up a lap, losing a lap situation for Gant. 11th position, Harper's car number 27. And Kaylee Arbro's back there. And three laps down is car number 12, Donnie Allison, with number 22, the leading rookie in the race. The leading rookie in the race, Elliott Forbes Robinson, the second best rookie, is the 13th position, which is Stan Barrett from Bishop, California. Barrett is running 13th overall on the field. The 14th position is Bill Elswick, and 15th overall is John Rutherford. Bobby Allison still in front and still looking like he is building sterner stuff with his car than some others out here today. But Buddy Baker has been flexing some muscles of recent as we move into the last quarter of the race. Let's go to Ned Jarrett down on pit road.
Ken, I'm still in the garage here. As you know, I've been spending quite a bit of time here as the cars are going out of the race at a quick rate now. We have 13 cars that are out of the race. You can see some of those in the background. They had to just park them and call it a day, and the latest one was Benny Parsons. He pulled it in here. Remember a little earlier, he had a radiator problem. They changed that radiator. It's still the one they put on there. Did not do the cooling job, so he had to just pull it in and park it for the day. So it looks like the pace they're setting out there is really taking its toll, and it might even pick up as the afternoon goes on.
43 lead changes thus far in the race. Here's Baker going underneath there again, and he'd like to make it 44. Coming around this time, he'll be 159 laps on the books, 397 and a half miles complete. There's Ricky Rudd in number 90. He's running in the sixth position.
Jody Ridley in number 9.
Here a year out of Jody Ridley. Correct.
Driving a car like Neil Bonnetts and Benny Parsons, but they don't seem to have been able to get quite the speed out of their car than the other two Fords. I thought they might show a little bit more form here, but I am informed by Judy Dunlavy, his crew chief, that he's just going to hang in there, and in fact, he is in fact hanging in quite well. He's running in seventh spot.
Here is Baker pulling up on the outside of Allison as they wrap. Jody Ridley going to turn number 3. Richard Petty still maintaining third. There you see him behind Baker. It's at this stage of the race that fatigue starts to play a factor, and according to Richard Petty, the worst part of this race is not physical.
Actually, the cars don't drive any harder or anything. You just have to do more driving than what you used to. But the driving part you don't worry about. It's just the idea of saying, you know, if I mess up a little, that man I'm running with messes up a little, we can be in big trouble.
He never said a truer word, as we've seen before many times on this television screen. When these guys have a crash, it very often, almost invariably, involves someone else. There we see Bobby Allison, number 28, leading Buddy Baker, number 1, down the back straight, into turn 3. Baker on his own seems to be able to run lower than the others. Richard Petty is now pulled up to third spot, right behind Buddy Baker. Harry Gant still in there, number 47, but of course some laps off the pace. Right behind Gant is Ricky Rudd and Dale Earnhardt. Maybe Dale's just biding his time.
Let's go to Brock Yates.
Ken, I'm with Lenny Pond, the latest retiree in the 500. Lenny, of course, the question, what was it?
Well, somehow the engine just turned in the backstretch. The engine just failed going in the backstretch, and I blasted it, and all pressure just shut off. I guess I've got a rock to off up on the pump.
Lenny, we're starting to get a real rash of retirements. All of a sudden, a lot of valves are breaking, and engines are blowing, and do you think it's a symptom of these new race cars, or do you think it's a problem with just a routine problem?
Well, I think everybody had to run a pretty low gear to run fast because you can't run through the turns like we used to run it. We used to run through them flat open just about all the way, and all day long, and now you can't run, I couldn't run but about 5 or 6 laps right over in the racetrack.
Do you expect we're going to get some more people falling out of here? Do you think we're going to get some more people falling out of here before this is over?
Well, I don't know. How much more race have we got to go?
About another 100 miles, a little less.
It'll be some more break before the 100 miles over.
Okay. Here's a prediction, Ken. Let's see what happens. Back to you.
Here's another one of the neat guys. He has been one of the star-crossed drivers on the Grand National Tour for a lot of years, but one of the very best. Lenny Pond out of this one. 162 laps complete. Still, Bobby Allison and the Gray Silver Ghost leads the Daytona 500. Change for the 45th time. Buddy Baker is now in front with Bobby Allison. They've got 46 lead change as they move towards the record for this race. We'll give you that in a moment. Baker back in front. Allison in second. And Richard Petty stays third on the field. Once we get our next flag-to-flag coverage coming to you on CBS, will be Sunday, March 15th, 5 to 7 o'clock Eastern Time. The first race for the World Championship Formula One this year. It'll be live from Long Beach, California. We hope you can be with us. Back here is another lead change. Make it 47 as Bobby Allison goes in front. Dale Earnhardt dives to the inside and takes second. Or tries to take second. No way.
Dale Earnhardt about to get boxed in there by a back marker or a slower car. Dale just having a go here to see where the run-up point's going to be because he's obviously going to want to try to win this race. He's been hanging around there in fourth spot. Just a few lengths behind the leaders. Now he's going to try and take it for a few laps just to see what it feels like out there.
14 cars out. Latest retirees, Cecil Gordon, James Hilton, Lenny Pond. They are the latest retirees. 14 of the 42 starters are out. And now Earnhardt begins to put the pressure on. One more pit stop. It'll be crucial if it's under green when they turn these cars over to the team on pit road. There's Dale Earnhardt, defending champion of NASCAR, making a run at Bobby Allison, who has a very shallow lead as he comes out of turn four.
I thought I saw a bit of smoke coming out of either Dale Earnhardt or Bobby Allison's car there as they went into turn one that last time around.
An astonishing race as they wheel down through the triangle and go back into turn number one. The crowd on their feet about this one. They're sensing that it's building for some sensational kind of finish. Allison in front, but he's been run down by Baker, and Baker's car is handling very loose at the present time. Let's go to Ned Jarrett.
We're standing by with Maurice Petty. Of course, he's the brother of Richard Petty out there. Richard's style over the years has been just hang in there as close as you can and then make a move at the end. Is that sort of the way it's working today, Maurice?
Well, we're just sort of hoping we can hang on long enough to be there when the end comes around to have a shot at it, so we'd all got our fingers crossed.
What do you talk to Richard about on the radio?
They just give him the times. Dale gives him the times. What everybody else does, they caution. He tells him there's a caution, what a wreck is.
You don't give him no advice on driving, huh?
No advice on driving. He does his own style.
Well, Maurice did a little bit of driving himself about 15 or 20 years ago. They're due for their last pit stop, or what they hope will be their last pit stop, in about 5 or 6 laps.
Elliot Forbes Robinson pitting car number 86. Back straight away. There's the Pontiac out in front. There's Elliot Forbes Robinson on pit road. Next time by, 30 laps to go. Only 30 laps remaining when they wheel through the trioval. This time through, 170 laps will have been completed, and there will be 75 miles running to the finish of this $770,000 race.
Passing flag is out. Kendall waving the blue flag. That's the passing flag. Trying to keep those slower cars down.
Baker following in second place in that red car number one, and Harry Gant in car number 47 is still hanging in there with this leading bunch, although he himself is some laps down. And there we see the blue flag. This is given to the drivers, the slower cars, to tell them to move over. The hot shoes are coming through, and of course in NASCAR racing here in Daytona, that means stay to the low groove, give the high, fast lane to the faster cars. Some people acknowledge it, some don't quite so well. Same flag in road racing, and it basically just means to move over.
Baker trying to fend off Dale Earnhardt, who stays right with him.
Baker into 3 and 4 again.
Richard Petty just waits back there for something to happen. Remember what happened here 2 years ago? Petty just sat there and waited, and at the finish,
there
we had all kinds of action.
There we see Baker, Earnhardt, and Richard Petty hanging into third spot.
Baker in second, Earnhardt in third, Petty in fourth. 47 is back on pit road.
I think we're about to see a rash of pit stops on the green. They're just about coming up to the right amount of laps, 172 laps down. They must be ready for a pit stop within the next 3 or 4 laps of the outside. So we're going to see some really heavy pit work, because this is going to be the last scheduled stop. This is definitely not a pit stop to mix up.
Next pit stop should be the final one in this race if there is no yellow. Next pit stop should be the last one. Just outside our booth, a man is watching this Pontiac with more than just passing concern. That man there, one of the most famous people in American motorsport, that's Smokey Unick, 1962. He built the car that won the pole, won the semi-feature, won the Daytona 500. Smokey Unick, he took it all with Fireball Roberts driving, watching this Pontiac. He hasn't been here for a few years. I don't think a lot of us will forget when he brought Curtis Turner here, and they went nearly 180 miles. They did go over 180 miles now, first time. And that was the guy, Smokey Unick, that put those cars together.
And he is a resident of this town, and there we see the leader, number 28, coming into the pits. We assume this is a regular stop for him, but this is going to be the final stop. He seems to be going awfully slowly to me.
He is running slowly coming in.
He slowed down very early.
Earnhardt is coming in front of him. Baker has come in front of him as he really came off the binders. Now he picks up speed and pulls down in. There is I-28. Let's go to Brock Yates.
They came in quickly. They're a little bit surprised. They were out of gas. The engine just been fired up. Certainly Bobby Allison fell out because they were planning to come in another couple of laps. It was a surprise stop. They changed the tune to right side tires and they're back out, but it could have been a major disaster if he'd run out of gas a little bit earlier than he did.
Well, that's going to build some suspense into this one. If they run to the finish from here, we've had two cars come in and get back out.
Ricky Rudd's waving his hand there out the left side of the car. Now, what's his problem?
Now, remember, he has no radio, so he's communicating by hand signal, smoke signal, or any way he can to J.C. Elder about his problems today. 170 laps complete, 425 miles officially down, and the speed is 167 miles per hour, as opposed to Baker's record a year ago of 176.
And there we see guess who in the lead of the Daytona 500. Car number 43, Richard Petty, six-time winner in this Daytona 500. Ricky Rudd, number 88, following him. Buddy Baker, number one, third. And Bobby Allison dropped back to fourth spot.
Seems like old times. Richard Petty back in front of the Daytona 500. Ricky Rudd pulling on pit road. Coming in for his stop, he has been running second. He had five cars running that lead lap. Rudd was on
I'm right here.
Let's go to Brock.
Ricky Rudd in this green flag stop. They're making a right side tire change and back underway. Everybody has made just two tire changes, so it looks as if the status hasn't changed appreciably other than that coasting stop that Bobby Allison made. Let's see if he can get it back.
Let's see if Richard Petty will come in this time. Looks like he's coming down. He is getting ready to come on pit road. Richard Petty, the six-time Daytona 500-mile champion, is on pit road to Ned Jarrett.
One of the fastest pit crews in the business, Dale Inman, the crew chief on this car. Maurice Petty, his brother, directing the traffic here as they go to work on the rocks. They're not changing tires. A change of pace here for the Petty crew. They're only adding gasoline and eat away. A very quick pit stop. What strategy? We'll see how it works.
176 laps complete. Up front, the battle for the lead. Number one, Buddy Baker, commanding 88 and 2, staying right there with it. 43 has pitted. Number one, Allison has some catching up to do.
Well, Richard Petty took a chance there. It took 6.8 seconds only to put gas in. He has maintained his lead even with the pit stop, and he's got about 1,000-foot. 1,500-foot lead on that group racing for second place, which is Buddy Baker, Ricky Rudd, and Dale Earnhardt. Behind them, trailing them by another 8,900 feet, is Bobby Allison, number 28, who has led more laps in this race than anybody else.
Let's get the interval now. Back to Bobby Allison. There's Petty back on the track. What a difference that stop made for him. He did not change tires. The crews using various strategy to try to get the cars out from here. Leaders coming around and enjoying first place as they come back in to try over another time. It is Ricky Rudd, second, Earnhardt in third. Then it's about 2 seconds back to Bobby Allison running in the next position. Correction, 43, your leader, then the battle with 88 as he did not take on tires. Petty maintaining first all by himself. Question me, can he stay there till the finish?
Well, if he runs out the race now, he's got another 23 laps to go, and he's already done about 30 laps on those tires, so they'll still only end up with about 50 laps on them, which is no real problem. They won't wear out, but they just won't be quite as quick as the tires on those new cars.
Can Petty run this set of tires to the finish and win the 500? We'll know shortly. Piece of pit stop strategy by number 43, Richard Petty, may be the catalyst that gives him a victory here for the seventh time in the Daytona 500 this afternoon. Right now, he has the advantage. Bobby Allison is back in the fifth position and trying to catch up with three other people who are number one, Buddy Baker in second, the 88 car of Ricky Rudd, the two car of Dale Earnhardt, and rapidly running them down is the man who set on the pole, Allison. Let's go get the story from the number 43 pits. Here's Ned Jarrett.
Again, as we noted, the Petty crew only added gasoline, and they only added one can. These cans hold 11 gallons. Now, when Petty pitted, there were still about 55 miles to go. They could run about 100 miles on a tank of gasoline here, and he was pretty close to out when he came in, so that's going to be very, very close, particularly with him out there running by himself. When they run in a draft, they're able to conserve some gasoline, but now he doesn't have the advantage of those front-running cars to draft off of. Of course, he picks up every slow car he possibly can, but will he burn more gas too much so that he can't make it on the gas that they took on? It's going to be awfully close, as his pit crew here reports.
Well, not changing the tires was a really not much of a gamble, but not putting in that second can of gas is going to be incredibly close, I would imagine.
And the interval is 9.6 seconds between the first car and the second car of 88.
So he is, in fact, pulling away from that second group because it's gone up from 8.7.
Here's the second place battle. Out they come from turn number four. Down to the line, Petty taking a tremendous gamble to try and win this 500.
So that's Ricky Rudd, Bobby Allison, Baker, and Dale Earnhardt, and Allison wound them in to about a 3.5 second deficit in four laps.
it just gives you the idea of the strength of that car of Bobby Allison's. That Pontiac of his has worked so well all the time. And just look at him actually pulling away from that group as they drive. Now, can he on his own wind in Richard Petty, who's got half a length of straightaway on him?
183 laps, 17 laps to go. Petty in front. The interval expands a little, David.
Does again, it's gone up to 10 seconds now. But Bobby Allison is leading that group now. Can he, in fact, help to wind them all back up to the back of Richard Petty to make this an incredibly close finish? And of course, as far as Richard's concerned, he may not even make it to the finish.
Check in the interval. The first and the second place car. 9.8. The interval between Richard Petty on the point, number 28, Allison.
We've seen some very good driving this afternoon. There's no doubt about it. These cars aren't twitchy. This is reflected in the low average speed, you know, compared to last year. They are difficult to drive. Everybody's kept their head very well. And Ricky Rudd in particular has put on a great display. Look at Richard Petty right up to the wall.
This is that wall like a handrail as he comes down into the tri-oval another time. Richard Petty, let's review back. In the sixth position at this moment is car number 90, Jody Ridley. In the seventh spot is the number 9, Elliott. Then a lap down is number 75, Milliken in eighth. Elliott Jones Robinson is ninth, and we have an update on that report. At the present time, they are now showing in the sixth position, Elliott. Seventh position, Ridley. Eighth position to Yarborough, ninth position to Milliken, and tenth position to Stan Barrett in the Hal Needham car. The 11th position to car number 57, Bill Elswick, and the 12th position belongs to Donnie Allison. 167-mile-an-hour average as Richard Petty rolls the dice pretty hard against the concrete, gambling well to win this Daytona 500. Richard Petty's lead is decreasing. His lead is now down to 8 6/10 seconds. What's the strategy? Ned Jarrett has a report.
Dale Inman, the crew chief. Dale, you've had the stopwatch on every lap. What's happening?
Ned, we're running pretty good. We're pretty well holding our own. We've lost about a second to him the last four or five laps.
He's coming up on some lap traffic.
Right,
what's
now,
that?
We just picked up about a half a second on a draft car. So we got 10 laps to go. Right now we've got a 9-second lead, and he lost a little ground that lap, and we gained a little bit, so there's 10 hard laps to go, Ned.
And you're going
to
be pretty close on gas, aren't you?
It's going to be close on gas, but we're safe on gas, Ned.
Hey, that's Dale Inman. He's clocking it off here, Ken, hoping that they can count him down and see Bobby Allison a little distance behind him when the white flag drops.
Lapping the 10th place car, number 22, Stan Barrett. It's number 43, Richard Petty. Interval stays. It's gone back to 9 seconds. Second place car is Bobby Allison. He's led it almost all the way, but now Richard Petty once again is exerting the strength of his Petty team. He first came here for the very first race in 1959. His dad won it. He went out early in the going that year, but here he is coming on strong today, going for his seventh.
And we saw the blue flag, Harold Kinder waving the blue flag at this block of slower cars, and Richard Petty's got to wind his way through, going high through turns one and two, up to, onto the back straight.
He laps Bill Elswick. He goes after Sanders, the rookie, in the Henley Gray car. Petty is caught in traffic, and Allison's coming down out of turn number two and gaining some ground back. Bobby Allison is definitely gathering ground back as car number 43, Petty, goes up into turn number three.
Allison is still 9 seconds behind, and we're down to only 8 laps to go. It will be 8 laps in about another half a second.
Let's go to Rock Yates with Waddell Wilson.
Waddell, one simple question. Can he catch him? Can he catch him?
No, I don't think there's enough time left. He gambled, and it looks like he's won by the way. Also, we run take it all the way on our right side tire.
The gamble was on Petty's stop. Could you have made it if you hadn't run out of gas on that last stop?
I didn't care.
Okay. It's so noisy down here, Ken, that I can't really make any sense with him, but he appears to have conceded this race. Waddell, one more question. Was the gamble on Teddy's part what beat you, or did you run out of gas as well?
Well, see, we run the car as far as we go on gas, but see, not only did we have to put go to the second can of gas, we had to change our right side tire. And I think all they did was take advantage over us.
Okay. Rod Wilson, a dejected man, and certainly a brilliant victory for the Petties if they can pull this off against a much faster automobile.
Petty ready to try and lap Jeff Bodine and Cale Yarborough as he exits turn two, checking the interval another time. Checking him as they go down the back straightaway. Allison in clear sailing the last lap, where Petty had to get around some traffic.
He still has a 9-second lead with only 7 laps to go. They aren't winding him in at all. They're making no appreciable ground on him at all. Jody Ridley pulling into the pits, number 90.
Crowd
in 7th spot.
Just can't believe this one. It looked like it was going to be Allison's almost all day. But in the last moments, it was in the very last lap in 1979 when Bobby Allison, Donnie Allison, Cale Yarborough, remember it was Bobby and Cale that were involved. Donnie pulled around. But now this time, it's been Bobby and Richard right toward the finish, and it's been the pit crews that have made the difference. 5 laps to go next time by.
I'm not counting the fact that Richard Petty has won this race yet, because there are 5 laps to go and no race is won until the checkered flag is dropped. But if he does win, it'll be absolutely unbelievable, because the Bobby Allison Pontiac has been the strongest car all month, and it was clearly the strongest car in this race so far, having led 117 laps.
Petty comes across the line. We're checking on that interval back to the second place car at the last. Allison, the interval stands at 8 7/10 of a second. 8.7 laps running down. Running to 196 right now.
And Buddy Baker and Dale Earnhardt, for some reason, they have dropped right off the pace. And it looks like young Ricky Rudd could finish up a very strong third in this race.
A great race for the Gardner brothers.
Richard Petty sitting in there, looking unconcerned in that close-up shot, but just look how high he gets in the middle of turn 3 and 4 there. Nobody runs closer to the wall than Richard Petty.
No one uses the tri-oval like Richard Petty. Likes to pass there. Well, there's the signal. Carol Kendrick putting out the marker to Richard Petty. 4 to go.
Into turn 1. Again, runs through turn 1, goes in low, comes right up high.
There's Allison running in second. Interval staying now at about 8 5/10 of a second. There's Petty out in front. Richard Petty and his crew. Interval comes down and shrinks a little to 7 6/10 of a second. 7.6, now the interval. Allison is going all out to try and catch Petty.
Absolutely willing that car on at this stage in the game. Foot pressed, absolutely mashed to the floor. We heard Lenny Pond say he couldn't run more than 5 laps wide open around here. You can rest assured that both Richard Petty and Bobby Allison are going around this track absolutely full throttle all the way. And whoever's got the best chassis set up is getting through these turns best, losing less speed and putting down the straights faster.
There's Bobby Allison, trying for his 62nd career win in this Daytona 500. Looking up from under as we look at the interval another time. It's down to 6 9/10 of a second between 43 and 28, the second place car. There you see Rutherford, who's running back in 12th. Richard Petty going for his 193rd career win in Grand National Racing. That's still to come. There's Allison coming to the line as we check that interval another time. It continues to shrink, getting closer all the time. It's now 6.5 seconds, but time is running out. A brilliant maneuver by Dale Inman and Maurice Petty may have given their cousin and brother, respectively, this Daytona 500.
Well, a lot of it depends on the driver, too. Richard must have said to them, don't change the right side tires. He must have told them not to change them. He was happy with the way it was set up. And that's what he told them to do, and they didn't. And they did a 6.8 second pit stop, and that's what's given him this race. It looks like he's going to win by about 6.5 seconds.
White flag coming up. One lap to go for Richard Petty, who looks like he's on his way to his 100th career win. I'll tell you, I want to be there the day he wins 200. The crowd up on their feet. One of the most beloved race drivers in the history of the sport. Going down into turn number two. You are watching an incredible moment in the history of motorsport. Here is a man winning the most difficult, most prestigious stock car race there is. For the seventh time, Bobby Allison.
The sort of
win situation.
The sort of strategy he pulled here is like sinking about a 90-foot punt to win the U.S. Open by one hole.
Out of turn number four, Richard Petty holding on to that lead like a hammerhead shark. Here he comes, coming down, seeking out. And is he slowing down? Is he running out of fuel? He's coming across the line slowly, but he takes the checkered flag. Cars in the wall. Stan Barrett has crashed just at the finish. Number 22, Barrett, has walled his automobile. Richard Petty has won it right at the finish. Stan Barrett has crashed car number 22. He's all the way up against the wall in turn number four, coming right down by our camera, holding it up there on the wall. He was running in 10th position. We have a replay of that incident. There is Petty, the winner. We'll meet him in victory lane in just a moment. Let's take a look at what happened to number 22, way down to the bottom.
Oh, he got on the apron at the bottom of the bank, and that's just absolutely fatal. Sends him straight up into the wall. It looks like he'd already hit the wall once and sent him down to the bottom. What a shame for Stan Barrett. Turn four, last corner, last lap. Boy, I mean, that is tough to take.
The crowd up and waiting now. Stan Barrett's going to drive this car across. He slid it all the way down the wall, stayed in the wall, and he's going to come across the line. How about that? His first Daytona 500. Looks like he's still going to finish in 10th position. Stan Barrett is coming across the stripe. That's all right. The crowd is awaiting Richard Petty. Here he comes in. And what a response he is getting from the 100,000 gathered today.
The disappointment in the Bobby Allison pit would be almost more than you could stand. It must be just absolutely intense. They had this race locked up all month, and they just somehow blew it with only 20-odd laps to go.
Well, here is one of the great masters of the sport, Richard Petty, scoring his 193rd career win. It would be something to be with him for number 200. No one has ever done it in the history of the game, won that many races in any form of motorsport, and he has just out-snookered them here in the 500, David.
Well, he's only got seven races to go to that magic 200. Boy, what a figure. Some people are happy if they win two races, and here we have a man that's won the Daytona 500 seven times, and nobody else has won it twice.
We'll try to give you in just a moment a rundown. There's Ralph Salvino from the sponsors of the organization. He has been a big Petty enthusiast for some 20 years in the blue jacket. Well, this right by Allison's pit. He'll go right by Allison's pit to go into victory lane. Happy family. Linda Petty. Richard is now a grandfather, you know, and I'm sure that the youngest member of the Petty generation is watching this one. Oh, he's probably here at the race. He hasn't missed one. He's about 4 months old. I think he's seen two or three races.
Absolutely incredible. Ralph Salvino looking through the screen at Petty, telling him what a great job he's done. Ralph, of course, obviously extremely pleased.
Well, this is the one they all shoot for. This is the one. Of course, the next biggest one is the World 600 in Charlotte, and you'll see that on CBS. Come to Memorial Day weekend.
I don't know what they're going to do when he does win 200 races. They're obviously going to have to strike some special award because no one else is going to get anywhere near it.
Sports Illustrated is going to have to put him on the cover. He's never been there, and there is one of the great sportsmen, one of the great race drivers of our time. Here he comes into victory lane.
He certainly deserves a cover of Sports Illustrated.
Trying to get out of victory lane to get a word with him. The history of this Daytona Speedway is much the history of the Petty family. Let's go to Ned, Jared.
When Richard Petty comes into victory lanes, he brings a crowd with him. No race driver has more fans than this fella. As he crawls out, he flashes that big smile. Richard, you pull one up.
Yeah.
They only have just out-figured him a little bit.
You know, we run all day long. We run with them. We couldn't outrun them. They couldn't outrun us. They just outsmarted them in the pits, and that's what won us.
Richard, I asked you the other day what it took to win this 500. This is your seventh one, and you said you had to have a lot of luck, but really luck wasn't it today.
Well, I tell you, I had a lot of luck just to miss everything that was going on out there, and I had a lot of luck. We run all day and didn't have no problems. And then we were fortunate enough to make the right decision on gambling right at last, and, you know, then our luck ran out. You know, I mean, it worked out, so couldn't have been planned any better.
Richard, how much of a gamble was that? Was the tires getting thin, and were you close on gas?
No, the tires were no problem at all. We could, Dale told me right after the first, second pit stop, said, tires are no problem. We can run them if we need to later on in the race. And so they had it all planned, and so it worked out good because it wasn't a caution. If it'd been a caution, then it'd been a heck of a race.
Richard, you have 500 miles now with these new cars. Everybody was very concerned about them going into the race. Your thoughts now?
They're still terrible, terrible squirrely, I tell you. I'm not a whole lot better than the rest of them. I think that by myself I was pretty good, but when I get with three or four of them, it was really bad, but I wasn't as bad as some of the rest of them.
Why are they so squirrely, as you say?
It's just aerodynamics, just the way the car's made, and there's just not a whole lot we can do about it right now. We'll work it out.
What can you, you said not a whole lot you can do, but do you have any suggestions for them?
I don't know. That fastback Pontiac deal didn't handle any better than we did, so yeah, right now I got no suggestion. All I know is my car handled better than everybody else, and we won the race, and I'm tickled to death.
Are you just going to keep winning races forever?
I'm going to keep on trying, Ned. You can bet on that.
Okay, you can bet on that, Ken.
Richard Petty coming to his 193rd career win, his seventh conquest of the great American race, the Daytona 500. Richard Petty. Coming to you live from Daytona, and right now they're prepping for the Grand Slam of tennis, McEnroe against Vilas, later today. Here you'll see it live on CBS. Right now we're getting ready to go back to Victory Lane, where the celebration continues for Richard Petty. His first cousin, who's been with him for every race but two in his entire career, is standing by with Ned Jarrett.
That's Dale Inman, seven-time champion, seven-time winner of the Daytona 500. Dale, what a brilliant move you fellas made out there.
Well, Ned, we kind of had it planned for a while. Our radios weren't working too good, and there's so much wind in the car, and then the other guys kind of slipped in on us before we was ready for them, and we'd had it planned that way. If it had been a caution, we'd have had the race. But it was far down the line, Ned. We'd had it figured that way for a good bit, and we was hoping we could catch them changing tires.
Richard said that he was not concerned about the tires. I'm sure that you had measured them all along and knew exactly how far you could go.
There was no tire wear at all in the 125-mile races. There was no tire wear all week, and we had projected that we could go right at a full race without changing left side rubber.
Dale, winning this race goes back a long way. Just what happened here today was not the total story.
We worked our rears off, Ned, to get ready for this race, and a lot of families have sacrificed because we've worked night and day to get ready.
When you say sacrifice, what do you mean?
Sometimes you have to put your family aside, seems like, to get the car ready.
Well, I'll tell you, this crew really knows how to do that. I know how appreciative you folks are for the dedication that the crew put in, the effort in bringing this car into Vickard Lane. Congratulations again, Dad.
Thank you, Ned. Maybe I'll be home tonight.
Okay, tells Mama he'll be home tonight. Boy, they don't waste much time. Once they get that victory under their belt, they load up and go home and get ready for the next one.
The next one will be Richmond, Virginia for the Petty crew. We're getting ready to give you a rundown here, hopefully a word with the second place finisher in this Daytona 500. The Petty family, they've done it again. Won the seventh time for Richard in the 500.